How's everybody doing? Everybody's good? Good, good.
Today's topic is called Growing Pains, Putting Away Childish Things. Growing Pains, Put Away Childish Things. That's today's topic. Kind of going into what the Yasop was going into earlier regarding Israel repenting, rising up, and maturing to the point where we become a threat to this society, this kingdom as a whole. So the first thing I want to do is I want to go into the definition of growing pains. Go there. Definition of growing pains. All right. It says growing pains, neurologic pains that occur in the limbs of some young children. That's when the child starts to grow and they get pains, and usually in their legs they get pains. And the second one I want, the difficulties experienced in the early stages of an enterprise. That's what I want to deal with. The difficulties experienced in the early stages of an enterprise. What enterprise next? Definition? It says enterprise. A project or undertaking, typically one that is difficult or requires effort. A undertaking, an endeavor, venture, exercise, activity, operation, task, business, proceeding. This truth is all the above regarding the, regarding an enterprise. This truth is an enterprise. All right? And as you can see, the water is rising. The understanding of the moon came out, and now we're keeping things properly. And that is the beginning of Israel, according to Revelation 11, rising up, as Deacon Yasser brought out earlier, rising up and becoming a threat, letting Esau know that he has but a short time. As the understanding progresses, that means his time, his time is also decreasing on this earth. His almost time is almost up. So remember, as we progress, his kingdom is starting to digress. That's a problem to him right there. All right? So you are going to experience difficulties in this endeavor or venture or exercise or project that requires or undertaking that requires effort through difficulty. That's what an enterprise is. Let's go to Ecclesiasticus 37 verse 16. Ecclesiasticus 37 and verse 16. Is that word in the Bible? Let's see if it's in the Bible. Sirach or Ecclesiasticus 37 verse 16.
The book of Ecclesiasticus chapter 37 verse 16. Let reason go before every enterprise and counsel before every action.
So reason goes into counsel, okay? Counsel, advice before every enterprise. So the words in the Bible is just with a Z rather than an S, Old English. Okay, enterprise. Go to, it says, go back to definition of enterprise again. The definition of enterprise, one more time. Synonyms, it says undertaking, endeavor, venture, exercise, activity, operation, task, and business. Okay, let's go to Luke 2:49. Let's see what the building the nation of Israel is. Let's see whose business it belongs to. Luke 2, verse 49. Verse 48. This is when Christ was 12 years old and he wandered off from his parents. Let's see what he said to his parents and they found him. 48.
Luke 2, verse 48. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing.
Read on.
And he said unto them, how is it that ye sought me?
What are you looking for me for? Go ahead.
Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business?
So he told his parents at 12 years old, listen, I got work to do. Don't you understand that? I got work to do at 12 years old. But he was still a child. Okay, but he said his father's business or his father's enterprise. You understand? We, the nation of Israel, are the father's business. The Most High only deals with his people. We are, everything he does revolves around us. The earth was made for us. The sun, the moon, the stars were made for us. Everything exists because we're here. Everything. So we are the father. We are the father's business. Let's go to Proverbs 24, verse 9. So when the Lord dealt with us, that was an undertaking that required much effort and there was much difficulty behind it. Because Israel, we as a nation, are rebellious as hell. Proverbs 24, verse 9.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 24, verse 9. The thought of foolishness is sin.
So the thought of foolishness in itself is sin. Simple thoughts is foolishness. Go ahead.
And the scorner is an abomination to men.
Go to 22, verse 15.
Foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, but the rod of correction shall drive it far from him.
So foolishness is sin, okay? Based upon 24, verse 9, where it said the thought of foolishness is sin. So foolishness is synonymous with sin. And foolishness is bound or found in the heart of a child. That's why we have to chastise our kids that have a covetous spirit. Because one thing, when you have children, you learn a lot requiring your people. Because when you have a child, you learn much from your child. You gain experience from your child. Your child has certain attributes that the nation of Israel has. They're stubborn, they're rebellious, they're covetous, they lie, they steal, they cheat. That's what kids do, because it's in them already. That's why we got to chastise them. And the Most High dealt with Israel the same way. We would steal, we were covetous, we would lie, we would cheat. We had adult tantrums. Israel the same thing. So the same way we dealt with our kids, the father dealt with his people, his children. Okay? We were children. Okay, let's get Ephesians 4 now. So when the Lord took us out of Egypt, Israel had a childish state of mind. They were childish. Ezekiel, I think it's 16. Go to 16. 2.
Is it the book of Ezekiel, chapter 16, verse 3?
Verse 2, excuse me.
Son of man, cause Jerusalem to know her abominations.
I mean, show my people their transgressions, Ezekiel. That's what the Lord's telling Ezekiel. Go ahead.
And say, thus saith the Lord God unto Jerusalem, thy birth and thy nativity is of the land of Canaan.
Your birth and your land of nativity is of the land of Canaan. You're acting like you were born out of Hamites. He's insulting us. Go ahead.
Thy father was an Amorite, and thy mother an Hittite.
You're acting like you were brought up, raised up by heathens. You're acting like heathens. Go ahead.
And as for thy nativity,
that's where you come from. Go ahead.
In the day thou was born, thy navel was not cut.
In the day you were born, your navel was not cut. Because when Israel came out of Egypt, that's the womb we came out of. Israel came out of Egypt. He's giving an analogy. We came out of Egypt. And usually when a child comes out of the mother's womb, what do? You cut the navel. You cut the umbilical cord. But Israel, when they came out of Egypt, they kept that umbilical cord on them. And they retained Egypt's customs while outside the land. That's why when Moses left, they made that golden calf. Because that cord was still not cut yet. Read on.
And as for thy nativity in the day thou was born, thy navel was not cut.
Go ahead.
Neither was thou washed in water to supple thee.
You were filthy with the abominations of the Egyptians. Go ahead.
Thou was not salted at all, nor swaddled at all.
You weren't cleaned off as of yet. Go ahead.
None I pity thee to do any of these unto thee, to have compassion upon thee. But thou was cast out in the open field to the loathing of thy person. In the day that thou was born.
When Israel came out of Egypt, no one cared about us. Only person that was looking after us was the Most High, the Lord himself. Go ahead.
And when I passed by thee and saw the polluted in thine own blood, and saw thee polluted in thine own blood.
So he's saying like a child comes out their womb, they're covered with all kind of fluids and so forth and blood. The Lord was the one that came over and said, okay, you guys are filthy and clean us off. The heathens didn't say you guys are filthy. The Lord came and gave us the commandments and the laws. That cleansed us. That washed us off. Go ahead.
I said unto thee, when thou was in thy blood, live. Yea, I said unto thee, when thou was in thy blood, live.
Hold that. Get Proverbs 7 and 2. What do you mean? He said, live, and that was it? What does it mean he said to Israel, live? Proverbs 7, verse 2.
My Proverbs chapter 7, verse 2. Keep my commandments and live, and my law as the apple of thine eye.
So the Lord told Israel to live. He said, keep my commandments and live. So when Israel came out of Egypt, they were washed off. The navel was cut by the Lord. They were cleansed. And so like a child comes out the womb, you wipe them off, you clean them, you swaddle them, you keep them warm, and you keep them clean. That's what the Lord did for us when we came out of Egypt. But Israel chose to keep that umbilical cord on them. Israel chose to keep that blood and fluid on them. They didn't want it off. They want it to remain on them. Go ahead. Go back to verse Ezekiel 16 again in verse 6.
Ezekiel 16 and 6. And when I passed by thee and saw thee polluted in thine own blood, I said unto thee, when thou wast in thy blood, live. Yea, I said unto thee, when thou wast in thy blood, live.
I cleaned you off with the commandments. Go ahead.
I have caused thee to multiply as the bud of the field.
I gave you children.
And thou hast increased and waxen great. And thou art come to excellent ornaments.
He dressed us very well. Go ahead.
Thy breasts are fashioned, and thine hair is grown.
Your breasts are fashioned means you have clothing on, you're dressed well, you're fashioned. Go ahead.
Thy hair is grown.
Your hair is cut, is nice, is grown. Go ahead.
Whereas thou wast naked and bare.
But before that, when you came out of Egypt, you were naked and bare. You was in sin, you weren't clean, you weren't taken care of. Go ahead.
Now, when I passed by thee and looked upon thee, behold, thy time was the time of love.
The time he saved us from our enemies. Go ahead.
And I spread my skirt over thee.
I covered you.
And covered thy nakedness.
Gave you the laws.
Yea, I swear unto thee, and entered into a covenant with thee.
With Moses. Go ahead.
The Lord God, and thou becamest mine.
We became his. Go ahead.
Then washed I thee with water.
What is that water going into? The commandments. Remember he said live. Proverbs 7 and 2. That's the commandments. That's the water he's talking about. Go ahead.
Then I washed thee with water. Yea, I thoroughly washed away thy blood from thee. And I anointed thee with oil.
Go ahead.
I clothed thee also with broidered work.
So the Lord dressed Israel. We were the best dressed nation on the planet. You see these so-called Japanese movies. They just thought, no. All these Asians copying us. Elam, Asians, so-called white folks. They still our fashion. Israel's the former of all things. The best fashion on the earth is Israel's. Everything came from us. So the Lord gave us the best fashion, the best embroidery. You know, you have embroidery in your clothes. You have a garment. You got the embroidery sewn in. We were bad. Israel had rubies, gems, gold sewn in their clothes. Even on this side of the world, when they came to this side, they were dressed the same way, beautifully. Go ahead.
I clothed thee also with broidered work. And shod thee with badger's skin.
Go ahead.
And I girded thee about with fine linen. And I covered thee with silk.
You think silk, you think the Silk Road. Asians, no. Israel wore silk. Silk, satin, that was us. We rocked that. That we had silk. Go ahead.
I decked thee also with ornaments. And I put bracelets upon thine hands.
That's your armbands. Go ahead.
And a chain on thy neck.
You know the Lord's black. You know he's a black man. He put the chain in your neck. You know how Israel love them chains. Gold, big gold chain. Father said, let me get them some gold chains. You know, black folks love gold chains. I love gold chains. Right? Right.
And a chain on thy neck. And I put a jewel on thy forehead.
Yeah, forehead jewels and our mitres, our hats. Go ahead.
And earrings in thine ears.
So you can wear earrings, Israel. Males and females wore earrings. No sin against that. Christianity is garbage. Somebody who can't wear earrings. The Lord gave men and women earrings. Go ahead.
And a beautiful crown upon thine head.
We were royalty. We were a royal nation. Go ahead.
Thus was thou decked with gold and silver.
So we had that in our clothes. Gold and silver. Go ahead.
And thy raiment was of fine linen.
Our raiment was of fine linen, the finest linen you could think of. We had it. Go ahead.
And silk.
Well, that word again. We had silk. You know how expensive that stuff is? Real, not that filk. Real silk. Real silk. Go ahead.
And broidered work.
Broidered work. Go ahead.
Thou didst eat fine flour and honey.
The best food.
And oil, and thou wast exceeding beautiful. And thou didst prosper into a kingdom.
That's the crown on our head. Go ahead.
And thy renown went forth.
Point. Hold on. This proves my point from earlier. And thou renown, your fame went forth. Go ahead.
And thy renown went forth among the heathen for thy beauty.
That's where the heathen got it from. You watch these movies and go, hey, they dressed bad. Them Asian flicks. Them Japanese. No. They got it from us. They'll show on TV, the movies, they'll show us wearing togas. Just like Greeks and Romans. We didn't dress like that. We dressed beautifully. How we dress back then, they can't copy today. They can't replicate it. They say, okay, let's just give them togas. Give them some rags and some stuff like that. We can't copy what they how they dressed back then. It's impossible to replicate. We dressed beautifully. And the nation saw that and said, we're going to copy that. Elam took it. Moab and Ammon took it. Esau took it. Assyrians took it. All nations saw us and said, damn it, dressed bad. We're going to copy that. Well, I saw oftentimes some of you on the street, we wear the fringes. I've seen it. You'll see Esau walk by us and take pictures. Then you look in the window of a store and see a shirt with fringes on it without ribbon of blue. No ribbon of blue, but it'll have fringes. I actually saw a dress for a child one day in the store with a ribbon of blue and fringes, the little puff fringes for little kids. So where the hell they get that from?
Exactly.
Where they get that from? They walk by, they like, oh, you see, so it'll go, click, a thing taking pictures. Click, 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 click. Like, oh, come on, man, really? He saw, you can't, he's not even conspicuous, man. He just, well, anyway, you get my point. These nations watch us. And they steal our fashion and say it's theirs. Likewise, all nations did that. Our fame went throughout the world. So the Lord, he blessed us with beautiful clothing, land, wine, oil, food, everything. But Israel, being childish, kept their childish ways. So the Lord had to deal with us like kids. So with Moses, the Lord dealt with Israel on a child level under Moses. When Christ set foot in the scene, Christ raised the bar. He raised the responsibility. He raised the level. He raised it to the point where Israel started to hate him because Christ said, listen, that's nonsense. We're going to do it this way. He forced Israel. He's forcing us now in the spirit even now to evolve above what we were before. I'm going to show you that as we go on. Ephesians 4, verse 10.
The book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verse 10. He that descendeth is the same also that ascendeth up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things.
That's right. Go ahead.
And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers.
In the body, each man has an office that's utilized to help benefit the body. Everyone has their rank. Everyone has their order. Everyone has their position they play. Everyone can play the same role. So Christ gave the church different roles to help Israel evolve, to progress, to be successful in the endeavor or the enterprise to help build the nation back to what it once was in its former glory. Have you read earlier in Ezekiel 16? Continue.
For the perfecting of the saints.
I love that word. For the perfecting of the saints. This is Ephesians 4, verse 12 now. Start from verse 10. For the perfecting of the saints. Perfecting means making us better, completing us, making us complete. Because right now we're still divided. So this is for the perfecting of the saints. Go ahead.
For the work of the ministry.
For what purpose?
For the work of the ministry.
That's the point I made earlier. For the work of the ministry, to strengthen the ministry, to bring forth the gospel, to spread it further, which helped to do what? Progress this truth, to help this truth evolve. And spread throughout all four corners of the earth so we can go home. This place is tiring. I don't know about y'all. I'm tired of this place. It's exhausting. Go ahead.
For the edifying of the body of Christ.
There you go again, which goes back to the work of the ministry. Saying the same thing. Edifying the body. Go ahead.
Till we all come in the unity of the faith.
That's the point of it. So that we all come into the unity of the faith. We all work together as one. This goes back to the men being apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. That's all to perfect us into one body once again, to unify us, to perfect us. Because to perfect something means to fix it. It was broken, now you perfect it, you fix it, make it better, reform it, convert it, make it born again. Go ahead.
Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God.
Now we all come into the knowledge of the Son of God. That's the part we want to deal with also. The knowledge of the Son of God helps Israel to mature at a higher level than our forefathers were under Moses. Under Moses, we were under a childish state of mind. I'll prove it to y'all. Okay, go ahead.
Unto a perfect man.
Read again. Unto what?
Unto a perfect man.
Unto a perfect man. Not boy, not child, a perfect man. A perfect man. Go ahead.
Unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ.
When you reach that stature, the fullness of Christ, you become a perfect man. It's that simple. Next verse, 13.
Verse 14. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro.
Stop. Read again.
That we henceforth be no more children.
Stop. That we henceforth, once you come into the knowledge of Christ and you become a perfect man, you become you're no longer children. No longer children. Go ahead.
That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro.
Because when you are a child that's tossed to and fro, children have short attention spans. They're here, they'll play with this toy and they're done with it. Play with that toy and they're done with it. Play with that and they're done with it. They're not focused. Children are unstable. In Israel, under Moses, was the exact same way. We were the exact same way. So in Christ, we're no longer children tossed to and fro, serving the two masters, serving the Lord. Look at the Christianity. Our people say they love God, but then they're in the world doing worldly stuff. I love God, but I'm going to get a tattoo. I love God, but I'm still hoeing. I love God, but I'm messing with this chick, that. No, you're still childish. You got Israel, know that Israel in that same mind as well. Same exact mind. Children tossed to and fro all over the place, not focused, unstable. Go ahead.
That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine.
Yes, Israel was. When Moses left Israel for 40 days, Israel's back in Egypt again, making golden calves, fornicating. Got Moses so angry, he broke the damn stones. He was so, what the hell is this? He lost it. The father said, listen, man, go on if I kill all of them and start again. Moses said, okay, I got it. And made them drink that gold. No, they died from that. You ain't drinking gold and surviving. He finished. He melted that golden calf in the river and made them drink that thing up. He dealt with them like kids, like having a child. Go get in the corner. The same thing, the same mindset under Moses. Same childish mindset.
Verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness.
That goes into today. Christianity is by the sleight of men. That's a cunning craft against our people that keeps us asleep. A cunning craft was taking the Sabbath day and making it the first day of the week. A cunning craft was taking the full moon and making it evil, making a black moon good, turning it around. Okay, making the end of the year the beginning of the year, vice versa. That's cunning craftiness by the sleight of men. Daylight savings time, New Year's Eve, Christmas Day, Halloween, having us worship Satan unknowingly, in ignorance.
When it says sleight of men, what is that talking about? What's that word mean, sleight of men?
Sleight.
You see the word?
Sleight. The use of dexterity or cunning, especially so as to deceive.
You see that? So it's being slick. Sleight means, huh? Cunning, especially so as to deceive.
Cunning deception.
You see that? So go ahead, Deacon.
It's a cunning deception. A slick or smooth lie. That's what it is. All right? By men. Go ahead.
Let me give an example of a sleight of sleight of men. In an earlier class, we was talking about what was done to us during the time of Rome. And I'm talking about in the history. They have it recorded in some of the historical books. One of the books in particular is named Eternal Rome. That's one of the history books that's out here. And it was put together by Grant Showerman. I think that's the name of it. And the person who wrote it or put it together. And the book goes into how Rome used, just like what we're reading, crafty practices to lure Israel from the Bible into pagan holidays. In other words, they added Babylonian, because that's what they were into, the Babylonian customs and all that. That's why it's Eternal Rome, because they were following Babylon. And they brought Babylonian customs and slight with the Bible. When to the point where they have Easter bunnies and rabbits talking about Easter, talking about and Sunday worship, they took the Babylonian Christmas tree and said it was Christ's birthday. And you got people in the churches today that believe that an Easter bunny, because right after Sunday service on quote-unquote Easter, in the backyard, where they got Easter egg hunt roll or whatever that mess is, the little kids be running out there talking about some chasing the Easter bunny with an egg rolling around somewhere. What does an egg and a bunny have to do with Christ?
You forget nothing. You forgot one thing.
Huh?
Immaculate Conception.
An Immaculate Conception. Okay, but the reason why I'm mentioning these things is because all of those are cunning practices on how they slip doctrine into and they use the Bible as a cover. That's the sleight of men that it's talking about here. You got me, yep. Deacon? Go ahead. That's it.
Go ahead.
That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine.
So when you're a man, you're not carried away with those doctrines. You're stable, you're clear, you're firm, you're steadfast. That's what happens. Go ahead. When you're when you're a child, you're all over the place. That's why we tell you, brothers, oftentimes when you read books outside the Bible, be very mindful, because we call them bones. There's information and there's misinformation in the book. Your first source should be the Bible. Anything outside of the Bible that you use to reference the Bible, make sure the Bible supports it. If it doesn't, it's garbage. But some of y'all fall for the garbage. And you put the garbage before the Bible. And that's how you confused about the moon and so forth. You all confused now because you them books, the sleight of men. Go ahead.
By the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive.
To deceive you. Because a child will believe anything. A child, you tell a child the sky is green, they're going to say, okay, the sky is green. You tell a child that they have 11 fingers rather than 10, they'll say, okay, I have 11 fingers rather than 10. Because that's how children are. But when you're a grown man, you're going, you talking about 11 fingers. I got 10. You sound crazy. Because you're grown. But when you're a child, you don't see those things. You're tossed to and fro. You're all over the place. Like, for example, Esau knows that when your child spends 40 hours in his school system and you at work, it's very hard to deprogram that child. Because the child, now you're telling the child, no, that's not true. Columbus didn't discover America. Now the child's being tossed to and fro. He's okay, he did discover America. He didn't discover America. It's hard. One of the biggest and craftiest sleights of men is the education system. That's one of the biggest ones. Aside from religion, it's education. That's one of the biggest sleights of men. All right? So now, let's get Corinthians 13:11. That's why it's our job to make it our job, our enterprise to stop that. And to get our children eventually out of these school systems and teach our children ourselves. That's what we got to do. Not just sit up here and complain a white man's the devil. That goes back to that evolving I was talking about earlier, where all you do is Esau's the devil. Israel, we have to learn to evolve beyond these things. The Bible's bigger than the white man's the devil. Turn the page, you'll see. It's bigger than that. But Israel hit their spiritual ceiling. They still with Moses. They still kids. Still got that umbilical cord. The neighbor ain't been cut yet. They haven't, because you know the child's cut. That right there shows that the child's been cut. It's now in the age where it's can grow on its own. Doesn't need a mom no more. There's a certain level. Once the navel's cut, that's a certain level of the body. The baby's body is now matured enough. We no longer needs that anymore. Read that. Corinthians 13:11.
The book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 13, verse 11.
Not that. Hold on. Start from verse 9.
Verse 9. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part.
No Israelite has 100% truth. All of us as a nation who teach this gospel know in part and teach in part. I mean, we know what the Most High gives us. Okay, we don't know everything. Anyone who says they do is lying to you. Go ahead.
For we know in part. And we prophesy in part.
Go ahead.
But when that which is perfect
that's
is
Christ,
come.
That's Christ on there. Which is perfect. Go ahead.
Then that which is in part shall be done away.
Then we'll know everything. When Christ returns, he'll say, no, that's wrong. This way. Oh. There ain't going to be no, I read this book by the white man. It says this. Off at your head. It's a wrap. Stab. Next, he don't listen. Ain't gonna be no talk and have a sit down with you in Matthew 18. That's not going on in the wilderness, y'all. Matthew 18 with Christ. I'm offended by you, Christ. I don't believe that scripture. Oh, you don't believe that scripture? Okay, stab. All right. You see what I said to him? No, I'm good. Okay, good. Ain't gonna be no Matthew 18 with Christ show up on him. Continue.
Verse 11. When I was a child, I spake as a child.
So this is Paul speaking regarding himself. When I was a child, I spake as a child.
I understood as a child.
Go ahead.
I thought as a child.
Go ahead.
But when I became a man, I put away childish things.
Now, what was Paul prior to being Paul? Give me some information about Paul prior to Paul. Hope that I'm not confusing now. Prior to becoming the Apostle Paul, who was he? Give me some of his background.
Shalom leadership, Brother Aaron.
Aaron, okay. Shalom.
Paul, before he came into the truth, he was taught in the school of Gamaliel.
Right, what was he?
He was a Pharisee.
Right, what was his name?
Saul.
Very good. Go ahead. That's it.
And he also killed, he held the coats when Stephen was being stoned.
Correct.
In Acts chapter 8.
Right, very good. So he was Saul at the time. He was raised under the tutoring of Gamaliel as a Pharisee. His father was a Pharisee. Okay? That's some of his background. So when Paul was under Moses, under the old covenant, understanding that, he made it clear, I was a child, I thought I was a child, understood as a child. He's referring to when he was under Moses, under the Pharisees. I'm going to say it again. He's referring to the time before he converted. That's what he's talking about. Because Paul was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. The man had status. He wasn't saying he was dumb. He was saying that his understanding was small as a child. When he was a Pharisee, his understanding was small. But when he followed Christ, he became a man. Understanding evolved beyond his own teachers, beyond the Pharisees that sent him to kill the disciples. His understanding evolved beyond even them, and they hated him for it. Read again.
When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things.
I'm going to share that later on. Go to Hebrews 5 and 12.
The book of Hebrews, chapter 5 and verse 12.
This is Paul speaking to the Hebrews now, men who will learn like him, Hebrew of the Hebrews. Go ahead.
For when for the time ye ought to be teachers.
He's telling them, when you guys are going to be teachers, go ahead.
Ye have need that one teach you again.
You got to learn all over again. What you know, you don't know. You don't understand what you're talking about. You're still kids. You're still young. He's basically, what they say in the street, he's sunning them. That's what he's doing. You guys don't know nothing. You got to learn again. You young bucks. That's what he's saying to them. Go ahead.
Ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God.
You must be born again. You must be taught all over again. Be converted. Go ahead.
And are become such as have need of milk.
See that? So he's calling them kids. You got to learn milk. He's writing to Hebrews. They know the law. He said, now you guys got to get milk. You're not ready for no meat yet. Because the child does not, a baby, you cannot give a baby any meat. They have no teeth. They'll choke. They'll die. So likewise, many of you in this room and the people he was talking to in this letter, they were like that. They were kids to him. Because Paul was a man in Christ. Understanding was evolved far beyond. That's why I told you that they perceived that the apostles were unlearned and foolish men. The disciples were bad. That's why the Pharisees couldn't stand them. That's why they asked, who taught this man letters? Mm-hmm. He didn't come to none of our schools. He wasn't out. Who taught him this? Remember, I tell you in Luke 2, I skipped it. He was 12 years old asking and answering questions at 12 years old, schooling elders. So who is this kid? And they were astonished, at his answers. Because he wasn't from any of their schools. Because when the Spirit of Christ enters you, you evolve beyond these so-called Christian leaders. You are beyond Christianity. It's like the joke to you, Christianity. You laugh at that stuff. Right. Modern Christians go, Revelations is sealed. No one understands that. You're like, no one understands that. Sure we do. You laugh at that stuff, but in Christianity, you're a kid. You don't know no better. The smallest thing, like women shouldn't wear pants. Millions don't know that. Millions don't understand that. Man shouldn't wear a dress. It's not in the world. Now, maybe some in the world, few, the old generation knows that. But as a whole, most of us don't understand that. Many of us, if you ask somebody today, what's the first day of the week? They're going to say the first day of the week is Monday. It's not Monday, it's Sunday. The seventh day of the week is Saturday. They don't understand that. Day starts at evening. The world doesn't even know that. Because our understanding has evolved beyond. We are the elite of our, in this room, are the elite of our own people. We are the elite. We've been enlightened. We're beyond the years. Some of us in this room are wiser than people who are in their freaking 80s in this room. Because in the spirit of Christ enters into you, you mature. You grow up. Our people are being trained in society to remain kids and boys and girls. Fun all the time. Party. But in this truth, you age faster. I'm seeing pictures of us from like four. I'm like, damn, bubbles look like they aged 10 years within two. Like, oh, damn, what the hell happened? Because this truth, it matures you faster. The world keeps you young, keeps you childish and all that. But when you in this truth, you grow the beard faster, your beard all long. You be 12 years old, a beard this long. You saw, and gray hairs on you. It's crazy. Nose hairs, ear hairs. Where the hell I get that from? Because the truth ages you. It ages you.
I guess y'all understand the reason why Christ's hair was fully white at 33, right?
Verse 12 again.
For when for the time you ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk.
You got to learn that. That's the first principle. You must learn that you need milk first. Somebody emailing me, can you explain Genesis? No, I'm not going to explain Genesis to you. You're a babe. Calm down. Be patient. You got to grow up first. You're still a baby. You're a damn fetus. No. Go ahead.
And not of strong meat.
Because you haven't excelled or evolved yet. You're still a child. Go ahead.
For everyone that uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness.
Milk means you're still learning to apply the commandments in your life. So you're still unskillful. You don't understand that you're not still yet. You don't understand that you're not committing adultery. You're still trying to trying to understand that. So you're unskillful. Go ahead.
For he is a babe.
You are a baby. Babe, go ahead.
But strong meat belongeth to them that are full of age.
That's excuse Paul. Me. A full age.
Yep.
Read again.
But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age.
That's why Paul spoke about aged men. The aged men and women likewise. Those who've excelled, those who've been through stuff, have experience, grown in this truth, applied and learned, years, experience. Go ahead.
Even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil.
It says their senses have been exercised, meaning it's constant. They've had practice. They've had experience. Children don't have that. When a child grows up and they go through experiences, they get their senses as time goes on. Their senses are exercised. They learn to discern both good and evil. But when you're a child, someone has to tell you, don't touch that. Don't do that. Leave that alone. Don't put your finger in there. Don't put a fork in that. Don't do that. Don't do that to your brother. Don't do that to your sister. Don't put that in her eye. Don't do that. Don't step on her face. Don't put your finger in her mouth. You got to tell a child all the time, don't do that because they're kids. Kids don't know no better. That's why it says in their heart is foolishness. Why are you putting your hand there? I'll touch that down there. You're like, what the hell you do that for? Because they're kids. They don't know no better. They're trying to figure themselves, you know, especially boys, figure themselves out. Women get all, mothers get all panicky. Why are you touching down there? You just found it. You don't know what that is. you know, babies, but it's his, whatever. You know, but that's they get older, they go, okay, after a while, they go, oh, that's what it's for. Okay, I understand. When they get to an age, they know what it's for. But when they're young, they don't know anybody. You got to show them, listen, this is for that, this and this. But likewise with the Bible, you got to show people what this is for, what this law is for, what that's for. But when Israel was under Moses, their understanding was but so far. When Christ came on the scene, their understanding evolved and they became men faster. They evolved faster. Even beyond the elders of the time. Let's go to Galatians 3 and verse 22. Got a lot more. Galatians 3, verse 22.
The book of Galatians, chapter 3, verse 22. But the scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe.
So, does the scripture have concluded all under sin? The scripture has concluded that all are under sin. Who's it all talking about? Let's go to Daniel 9:11. Very good. Let's see what the all is. That the scripture has concluded are under sin. Was it all nations? Let's see. Those of you who watch Monday Night's class are familiar with this. I went over this for the past month now regarding Paul's letters, on how to deal with them. So those of you who've been watching Monday evening class, you're already familiar with this chapter already.
The book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 11. Yea, all Israel have transgressed thy law, even by departing, that they might not obey thy voice. Therefore the curse is poured upon us, and the oath that is written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, because we have sinned against him.
That's it. So it says, all Israel have transgressed thy law. That's the all that's included in scripture to be in sin. Y'all follow? Galatians 3 again.
Galatians 3:22.
Galatians 3 is by far one of the hardest chapters that Israel gets over. They pull Galatians as if that's their trump card against us. Galatians, I got you. In the street, they always come at us with this Galatians 3 stuff. Always. Read it.
Galatians 3:22. But the scripture have concluded all under sin.
Uh-huh.
That the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe.
22:23.
But before faith came,
Jesus Christ came, synonymous with faith, go ahead.
We were kept under the law.
Stop. He said, before faith came, we were kept under the law. Who is Paul talking to? See how easy that is? When you mature, you see it. When you're a child in Christianity, you're not going to see that. Just that word we alone is destroyer right there. It just destroys the entire argument. We, who Paul's referring to himself and those he's writing to, were kept under the law. Only Israel will see the laws under Moses. I don't recall Moses giving the laws to all nations. That ain't in the Bible. Ask the Christianity lovers out there, when did Moses give his laws to all people? You're not going to get an answer. Read again.
But
before faith came, we, who were concluded to be under sin, in the previous verse, were kept under the law. We were kept under the law. Go ahead.
Shut up unto the faith.
Locked in or bound to. Go ahead.
Unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed.
Who's that talking about? Very good. So we were kept under the law of what? What law are we kept under? Very good. Law of animal sacrifice before faith, before Christ set foot on the scene. Continue.
Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster.
Wherefore, the law that we were kept under was our schoolmaster. Pay attention to the words being used here. Schoolmaster. Who goes to school? Now, adults go to school. But this is going into schoolmaster requires a teacher. You're a student. So a teacher compared to a student is a parent and a child relationship. It's the same thing. Parent-child relationship. Teacher-student. Read again.
Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith.
So read on.
But after that faith has come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster. For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus.
There we go. Go to 24 again.
Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster.
I like he's putting that emphasis on that. Emphasis on that. Our schoolmaster. The same we he was talking to, the law was our schoolmaster. Which is the law of sacrifice. Go ahead.
To bring us.
Us is the same we who were kept under the law. Go ahead.
Unto Christ that we.
That we, the same we who were kept under the law. Go ahead.
Might be justified by faith.
Through his son's death. Go ahead.
But after that faith has come,
now that Christ is revealed and showed up. Go ahead.
We
are, again.
are no longer under a schoolmaster.
We're going to find out what that schoolmaster is later on. Go ahead.
For ye,
who is the we, who are kept under the law, go ahead,
are all the children of God by faith in Jesus Christ.
So the ye is the us, the our, and the we. It's Israelites. It's just that plain. It's that simple. Now, let's get to the schoolmaster. Let's get Acts 13 and 38.
You know what's beautiful about what was going through? Because we've been on the streets. Actually, we used to bring this out many years ago. And when the so-called Christians come and they think they got a trump card,
yes, they have.
They be coming up and like, well, you won't read my Galatians. And we be holding it back because they think he won't read his Galatians. That's because it's going to tear him up. Watch this. Then they bring it out. Then we destroy their behinds in this, and they sit there and look dumb like a razor just cut across the face. Pull up. That's a beautiful thing, too. I love destroying that Christianity spirit. I love tearing it up. Go ahead, man.
38.
Acts 13:38. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins.
Go ahead.
And by him all.
Hold on, slow down. Where you at? Acts 13, verse 38. Read again, 38 again.
Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren,
go ahead.
That through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins.
Go ahead.
And by him all. That believe.
And by him, all that believe, go ahead.
Are justified from all things.
What are they?
Justified.
They're justified. Go
from
ahead.
From all things.
From all, what's all things?
From which?
Oh, wait. What's all things? One word. Sin. All sin. Justified from all sins. Go ahead.
From which ye could not be justified by the law of Moses.
So. The law, which was our schoolmaster, we're no longer under that because Christ died for us, and that death led to a forgiveness of our sins that we cannot receive justification from under the animal sacrifice. For example, if you are a witch, you get death. There's no, I repent from that sin, I'm sorry. No, there was death because there was no animal that you can use to justify or atone for your sin, for that sin. If you are in homosexuality, you cannot use a lamb for that. You got death. Your blood was shed instead. If you committed adultery, death. If you broke the Sabbath, death.
You lied,
death. You understand? Wicked children, death. They got death. It was just death all across the law. Man, I tell you, man. The law was a beast. Right. Under Moses, it was just death. That guy picked up sticks. Right. What do we do to him? Yeah, just kill him.
Just kill him.
They're like, damn. Then wear fringes so you don't forget again. Wear some fringes so you don't forget again. That's where fringes came from the death of a man. Then the Lord, man, he didn't play with us because we were in that childish state. Like your child do something wrong. Hey, stop doing that. You want them because children do simple things. So the law was on us hard. So under the laws of Moses, there was particular sins we cannot be reconciled or atoned for or be justified from. Through animals' bloodshed, only our own could atone for it. Hey. So through Christ, we receive an atonement from all sins. Because if we were under Moses still, we all in this room be doomed. All of us would be doomed. In fact, Israel be finished. We'd be erased entirely.
I'm going to help y'all out with something. There's a scripture in Hebrews that said, there shall not be any redemption without bloodshed, right?
Right.
Could you get that real quick? I ain't going to be long. I'm going to show you. How deep what Deacon Ithon said, because a lot of times we play around with the Most High and don't understand how serious this grace is that the Most High gave us.
Hebrews chapter 9, verse 21. Moreover, he sprinkled with blood both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission.
Without shedding of blood, there is no remission.
That's it.
So listen to this. Now give me one of the laws in the back where it says their blood shall be upon them.
Leviticus 20:13.
Listen to this one. Because I'm going into what you just said. Watch this. Now while he's getting that, when you read about the laws, the different laws that's required for different animals and different sins, that had to be, the different animals that had to be used for a particular sin, when it came to certain laws that you broke, there was no animal that could be shed. You got it?
Leviticus 20 and verse 9. For everyone that curseth his father or his mother shall be surely put to death. He hath cursed his father or his mother, his blood shall be upon him.
So when the scripture said that there is no remission of sin without bloodshed, that in this case here, you couldn't get a lamb or a bullock or an ox or anything and shed that blood to forgive you of sin. But the Most High still wants blood to be shed. So guess what blood got to be shed? Your own. That's when the sin is forgiven, when your behind is dead. Y'all get that? So it's not like you could get an animal and say, well, shed that animal for me. Because some of the sins required that. But there are certain ones where you couldn't get nothing. So, but the Most High said, but some blood still got to be spilled. Yours. That's what it meant when it says their blood shall be upon them. That's the blood. Because I'm going to require blood somewhere. I'm not going to get it from a lamb. I'm not going to get it from an ox, a turtle dove, nothing. I want to get it from you. That's what that means. That's heavy, ain't it? Just imagine that. You committed something and the forgiveness of sin, you had to die. Then the land is healed when your behind is dead.
Get the same book. Go to Hebrews 8 and verse 7. Go to verse 6, actually. Go to
Hebrews chapter 8, verse 6.
Yeah.
But now hath he obtained a...
I'm sorry. So the law, the schoolmaster in Galatians is referring to what? The schoolmaster? Law of sacrifice. That's the law of Moses in Acts 13, verse 39. Let me write that down. The schoolmaster in Galatians 3 is the law of Moses, or the law of sacrifice in Acts 13, 39, from which he cannot be justified under. All right.
I hope y'all understand it, because I was waiting for that answer to come up. The law of Moses is specifically talking about the laws of sacrifice.
Right.
That's the old covenant that it's talking about.
Right.
The laws of sacrifice.
That's the schoolmaster. Go to Hebrews 8 now, verse 6.
Hebrews 8 and 6. But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant.
Of a better covenant. Go ahead.
Which was established upon better promises.
Upon better promises. That's that perfecting. All right, read on.
For if that first covenant had been faultless.
So if there were no fault found with Israel under the old covenant, which required keeping the commandments coupled with animal sacrifice. Go ahead.
Then should no place have been sought for the second.
Then why would the Lord make mention through the prophets of a second one to come if Israel's going to keep the first one perfect? Because Israel made it a habit after a while of, okay, I committed adultery, I'll just offer the best sheep I can. I committed idolatry, I'll set up the best goat, lamb, turtle dove. Lord, what the hell is this? They're giving me the best animals and they're committing the worst sins possible. The Lord, after a while, said, you don't think the hell with these animals after a while. The animals were temporary. They were leading us up to Christ. That's what Galatians 3 said. They were a schoolmaster until faith, so the faith should afterwards be revealed. They were that schoolmaster that was to teach us how to atone until eventually accepting Christ's atonement for us as a nation. Hebrews 8, verse 8.
Verse 8. Hebrews 8, verse 8. For finding fault with them.
So Israel, the Most High, found fault with us under the first covenant. Because we were sacrificing sin. Sacrificing sin. We didn't take it seriously. We didn't take the Lord seriously. Or we would sacrifice the worst animal possible. Animals on dope, one's on crack, one got three legs, one got two, one eye. So what the hell? I didn't ask you for this. What is this? So after a while, the Most High said, you know one thing? The Most High said, no more of that. I'm going to send my son down. These guys, it's a waste of damn time.
That's the same thing like Cain. Cain knew the law, and he knew what he was supposed to bring. And he brought bushes, some trees or something. That Most said, what the hell is
plums.
This?
Some plums and peaches.
Right. He said, if thou doest well, would not thou be accepted? Same thing goes with us. That's why the Most High said, cursed be he that bringeth forth a male, what was it in Malachi?
a curse, a deceiver, that bringeth forth a male, and bring forth a corrupt thing.
Because that's what we were doing, bringing up broken legs and just like what you're saying.
Yeah. So he found fault with us. Read again, 8 and 8.
For finding fault with them, he saith, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah.
That's the covenant we're in now. Go ahead.
Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord.
Them is referring to us and our sacrifices. So that was done away with. Okay, now go to chapter 9, verse 1. Let's jump down.
What book?
Chapter 9, verse 1. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 1.
Hebrews 9 and 1. Then verily, the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service.
So the first covenant had ordinances of divine service. Ordinances of divine service. Go ahead.
And a worldly sanctuary.
And a worldly man-made temple. Read on.
For there was a tabernacle made, the first, wherein was the candlestick and the table and the shewbread, which is called the sanctuary.
The temple. Jump to verse 15 and 16.
Verse 15. And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament.
So for this cause, he is a mediator of the New Testament. Go ahead.
That by means of death.
That by means of his own death. Matthew, read this again slow. Read again. That's my favorite verse. Read this again slow. Watch this.
Which verse?
15.
Verse 15. And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament.
And for this cause, he is the mediator, because when Christ died on the cross, he ended the first covenant and he established the second. When you read Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 10. This is chapter 9. All right? 15 again.
And for this cause, he is the mediator.
That's the one thing. Jump to verse 12 so you don't get the context. Jump to verse 12.
Verse 12. Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us.
Eternal justification or atonement for us as a nation. He ended, so by him dying on the cross, he ended animal sacrifice. He ended the schoolmaster. You follow? Now jump down to verse 15.
And for this cause.
And once he died, go ahead.
He is the mediator of the New Testament.
And now he is the Moses was our first mediator under the old. Christ is our mediator under the new. Go ahead.
That by means of death.
That by his own death. Go ahead.
For the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament.
Why did he die? Read again. For?
For the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament. Testament.
Christ died for the transgressions of those who were under the first testament. So that's your God, soul of the world right there. Read again.
For the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament.
So when Christ died on the cross, he redeemed us from our transgressions who were under the first testament. Moses did not have all nations under the first testament. Only Israel was under the first testament. That's who Christ died and redeemed from death. That's who Christ died for, to redeem us from death, from our sins. You follow? 9:15 destroys John 3:16. Any thought of John 3:16 in your mind, it should be gone at this point. The world he's referring to is Israel. And Hebrews 9:15 confirms that. Read it one more time for the.
Hebrews chapter 9 and 15. For the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament.
Whose transgressions are under the first testament? There you go. Who did Christ redeem? That's clear. Go ahead.
They which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance.
Those who are under the first testament who are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. That's better promises than what Moses gave us under the Old Testament. The Old Testament is receiving the promised land, which we lost. Now we receive the planet and everyone else and everything on it. That's the better promise than living forever in the process. Verse 16.
For where a testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator.
Exactly, because Moses established the testament, he died. Christ established New Testament, he died, but he came back. Okay, but the point was for him to die. And once he died, that set us in the new covenant right there. That established it right there. All right? Now, let's go to Galatians 4, verse 1.
The book of Galatians, chapter 4, verse 1.
Now, chapter 4 is continuing from chapter 3. So it's the same thought, but Paul's giving now in a different analogy. He went from law to schoolmaster. Keep that train of thought in mind. Okay, this is Galatians 4. Remember, the Bible is one long letter. Prior to the letters, it was the chapters and verses were given later for reference. It's one long letter. All right? Read that.
Galatians 4 and 1. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child.
So now, the heir, as long as he is a child. Remember what I was saying earlier? The heir, as long as he is a child. Go ahead.
Differeth nothing from a servant.
He has no difference from a servant because, go ahead, continue.
Though he be Lord of all.
Though he be Lord of all. What's that mean? Next verse is going to explain it. Verse 2.
But is under tutors and governors.
That child is under tutors and governors. He's talking about a king. A child that's a king. A prince. He's talking about a prince. Israel, as a nation, we are a prince. The prince of God. Go to verse 1 again.
Now I say that the heir.
The heir is the children of Israel. The prince. Go ahead.
As long as he is a child.
As long as he's a child. Go ahead.
Differeth nothing from a servant.
Go ahead.
Though he be Lord of all.
We are servants because we serve the Most High. That's the king. Christ is our king. His father is the main king, supreme king. So we are princes. So we're even though we're lords, we still serve. We still serve. Likewise, a king over the people. He's a king, Lord of all the people, but he still has to serve the people. Y'all follow? Even though he be Lord of all, he still is a servant of all. Continue.
But is under tutors and governors.
So that child, when a child becomes a king, before he becomes king, he must be groomed under tutors and governors. Y'all follow? It's like a child prince, the son of a king. He's under tutors and governors while his father's alive to groom him. So when his father gets old and passes on, he holds the mantle. He takes over. He becomes the successor. Y'all follow? Go ahead.
Until the time appointed of the father.
Stop. Read 1 and 2 one more time.
Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child.
As long as he is a child. Go ahead.
Differeth nothing from a servant.
Go ahead.
Though he be Lord of all.
Go ahead.
But is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the father.
Who are the tutors and governors in Galatians 3? Who are the tutors and governors in Galatians 3?
Shalom, the schoolmaster.
Why you say that?
Because the schoolmaster is the law that was teaching us how to keep the laws until Christ came when we had faith.
Very good. So what were we under the schoolmaster? What were we in Galatians 4 and 1?
We were children.
Very good. It's that simple. Under the laws of Moses, animal sacrifice, we were in a childish state. We were children under the old covenant. Children. That's why I gave y'all Ephesians 4 that says, when you follow Christ, you become a perfect man. And no longer children tossed to and fro. When Paul said, when I was a child, thought a child, understood a child, when I became a man, I put away childish things. Y'all follow? So the child, as long as that's the heir, as long as he's a child, is nothing from a servant, but is Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors. The tutors and governors is the bulls and blood of goats. The old covenant. Then when Christ set foot in the scene, we had to become what? We had to become men at that point. Grow up. Right, old foolish Galatians, right. You understand? So now, is that all I want? Read verse 3. Let's continue. He's going to say it. Watch. Verse 3.
Verse 3. Even so we.
Stop. There go that word again. Even so we, who were kept under the law, back in Galatians 3 and verse 23. Go ahead.
Even so we. When we were children.
Notice he says, when we were children. He ain't talking about childhood. Talk about your understanding. When we were children. Go ahead.
were in bondage under the elements of the world.
What's that talking about? We're in bondage in the elements of the world. Well, it's twofold. Let's see what gets the first part. It goes, it's still going to Galatians 3. It hasn't changed. It's saying one up first, right here. No, not you, Obadiah, not you. Behind you, who's, yes, yeah.
Shalom.
John.
He's talking about we was all under sin.
Right, and what else? Under the sin, what we had to do?
We had to sacrifice animals.
Same thing, exactly. Animals in the same exact thing. We were children having to offer up animals every year because of sin. We had to offer up animal sacrifices year by year. That's what Hebrews 10 says. Let's get it real quick. Hebrews 10 real fast. A little faster. Hebrews 10 and verse 1, just to show that.
Hebrews 10 and 1. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things.
Because those animals were a similitude or a foreshadowing of Christ's body itself. Go ahead.
Can never with those sacrifices.
Now we know what the law is. Remember, I said the law is our schoolmaster. Now he's telling you the law never with those, can never with those sacrifices. Go ahead.
Which they offered year by year continually.
Which we offered year by year continually. Why? Go ahead.
Make the comers thereunto perfect.
Could not make us righteous. Read the next verse. Going to say it again. Because Paul would oftentimes say the same thing 2 and 3 times. If you didn't get the first time, he'll say it again. He'll say it towards the middle. He'll say within the verse or under the verse. Paul was very redundant. We continue.
For then would they not have ceased to be offered.
If offering an animal made Israel perfect, then why keep offering them? Why keep offering them year by year if offering it one time was enough? Because Israel was sinful. So they'd offer up an animal year by year, whether it was done willfully or in ignorance. That was not worthy of death. We offered up sacrifices for it. Continue.
Because that the worshipers once purged should have no more conscience of sins.
He says, so if animal sacrifice was perfect, it should have taken away the sins out of our minds. But it didn't. Why? Because there was simply a schoolmaster or boot camp leading us to the ultimate sacrifice to believe in. And a lot of Israelites during Christ's time, they won't let that go. Now, realizing that later on, the temple is going to be destroyed and they would have no choice anyway. Read on.
But in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again made of sins every year.
Remembrance again made of what?
Remembrance again made of sins every year.
See that? Because Israel would sin, so every year by year we had to offer up animals. Go ahead.
For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins.
See, that's how we know it's referring to the schoolmaster. All right, so let's go back to Galatians again.
Galatians chapter 4, verse 3. Yeah. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world.
Go ahead. The animal sacrifice and sin. Go ahead.
But when the fullness of the time was come.
Stop. Where's that at? Fullness of the time was come. Where's that at in Galatians 3? For when the fullness of the time was come. Where's that at in Galatians 3? For when the fullness of the time was come.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Galatians 3:23, when it says, when it's going to the new covenant.
What does it say? Quote the verse.
All right, hold on. But before faith come, we were kept under the law.
Very good. Before faith came. Same. He's saying, I told you, Paul will repeat himself over and over again. If not in the same chapter, under the verse, before the verse, in the middle of the verse, he repeat himself over and over again. Galatians 4 again, where you was at, 4 and 4?
Verse 4. But when the fullness of the time was come,
go ahead.
God sent forth his son.
That's the faith that should have to be revealed. Go ahead.
Made of a woman, made under the law.
Made of a woman, made under the law. Go ahead.
To redeem them that were under the law.
What was Christ sent to do?
To redeem them that were under the law.
Where you get all nations from? To redeem them that were under the law. Galatians is dangerous. Why do people Christians keep using this for? This is detrimental to them. This is bad. This is bad. Read again. Galatians, read 4 or 5 again.
But when the fullness of the time has come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law.
Because Christ was born in a time when Israel was under the what? Old covenant. His mother offered up sacrifices when he was a child. So he was made under the law as well. And spoken of in prophecies found in the law. In Genesis 49, in Deuteronomy, in Exodus. He was made under the law as well. Read again, verse 5.
To redeem them that were under the law.
He was made under the law to redeem them that were under the law. Not to redeem them that were outside the law, who were under the law. Or in Hebrews 9, 15, under the First Testament. It's redundant. Go ahead.
That we might receive.
That we, go ahead.
Might receive the adoption of sons.
This goes back to being redeemed. Adopting and redeeming is synonymous. Being brought back to the Father again. Under the old covenant, the Lord forsook us. Christ died, he adopted us back to his Father through his death, or redeemed us. Look at the word deem, definition of deem, please. Right. Deem means to regard or consider in a specified way. To regard or consider in a specified means a particular way. So when you deem something, you regard or consider it. And when you redeem, you regard it and consider it again. The Lord never redeemed or guarded all nations before. Redeem means to consider or regard them in a specified way again. So who did the Lord deem in the past? It's that simple. When you redeem, reconcile. Reconcile means to conciliate or to come together again. What, something that was once together in the past. To deem something again that was once yours in the past. When you repent, you are sorrowful for something that you did wrongfully in the past. Who broke God's laws in the past to repent from? Israel. It's very simple. Christianity is horrible, man. I'm telling you, it's damn near worse than drugs. It's worse. It is worse because the words are right there. But when you, as you progress in this truth and you grow in Christ, you'll see these things. It's very simple. Some of y'all read this Bible back and front all your life and go, I never came across that before. Read it a million times. Jump down to verse 9.
But now after that ye have known God, or rather are known of God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements?
Where is weak and beggarly elements in this chapter?
That would be in verse 3.
Okay, what does it say?
Even so, when we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world.
Right, we were in bondage under the elements of the world. It goes into sin and animal sacrifice, in which we did what? Year by what? Year. Continually. It's very simple. Y'all understand so far? I know Paul's letters are very hard, but I'm trying to make it as simple as I can through the class. All right, so now let's go 4:9 again and 10.
But now, after that ye have known God, or rather are known of God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements, whereunto ye desire again to be in bondage?
What are we in bondage under? Under what? Law. What would y'all say? I'm hearing different answers. Law, y'all not sure. Let's get Acts real quick. Acts 15.
Acts 15 and 1. And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved.
So certain men who were sent out by the disciples to teach our brothers who were scattered abroad throughout Galatia, throughout Colossae, throughout Ephesus, throughout Philippi, the disciples sent them out to teach one thing and they taught contrary to it. Y'all understand? So let's say we up here sent five brothers out to teach the gospel of Christ. They left and said, okay, we're going to teach that you must be saved only through Moses. They were the devil. They infiltrated the church, pretended to be just men, were sent out by the leadership and taught contrary to Christ. That's what they were doing. They were confusing the churches that were scattered abroad. You understand? Jump to verse 5. It's going to say it.
Verse 5. But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees.
See that? Certain of the sect of the Pharisees.
Which believes.
Which for false believers. Go ahead.
Saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses.
Law of animal sacrifice, which we cannot be justified under, based on Acts 13 and 39. Now verse 15. I mean verse 10.
Verse 10. Now therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear?
Where's the yoke that neither us or our fathers are able to bear in the book of Hebrews? Where's the yoke that neither us nor our fathers are able to bear, the yoke which our fathers nor us are able to bear in Hebrews, in the book of Hebrews? Only one hand, no one else knows? Two hands. Three, four, five, six.
Hebrew 8, verse 7.
Thank you. Read it, please.
Hebrews 8 and 7.
Yes.
For if that first covenant had been faultless, then shall no place have been sought for the second.
Right.
For finding fault with them.
He found fault with us, so we were unable to what? Unable to bear the yoke of it. Animal sacrifices, Israel, what? They would offer animals year by year, and they were still imperfect. I know it's kind of hard, but some of y'all had it, so that's why we got to ask. I gave the answer away as far as I'm concerned. Did y'all understand? The yoke is referring to the yoke of bondage, the animal sacrifice. We were bound to that. We were bound to that law under Moses. Y'all understand? That's the yoke. Bondage and yoke are synonymous. Let's go back. Jax, let's go back to where I was at before. Go to Galatians 4 and verse 9, I think it was at before.
Acts 15?
No. They got it now.
Galatians 4.
Verse 9.
Verse 9. But now, after that ye have known God, or rather are known of God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements, whereunto ye desire again to be in bondage?
So what happened was, remember Acts 15. They were being seduced back into following what? Back into animal sacrifice. All right, they're going back to animal sacrifice. Go ahead.
Ye observe days and months and times and years.
So they began to observe months and days and times and years. How you know what I want? You know what I want, Ezekiel. They begin to observe days, months, times, and years as they were being fooled by that set of Pharisees in Acts 15 into offering up what? They're being circumcised and going after the manner of Moses. That's animal sacrifice. Back into that yoke again. That Christ freed us from through his death. All right?
This is the book of Ezekiel, chapter 45 and verse 17. And it shall come to, and it shall be the prince's part to give burnt offerings and meat offerings. And drink offerings.
Drink offerings.
In the feast.
In when?
In the feast.
Go ahead.
And in the new moons.
Months.
And in the Sabbaths.
Times.
And in all solemnities of the house of Israel.
Years.
He shall prepare the sin offering and the meat offering and the burnt offering and the peace offering to make reconciliation for the house of Israel.
So who did that for us when he died? Right. So do we offer those animals? Do we offer up those sacrifices now, those offerings now?
No.
So how the Galatians begin to observe days, months, times, and years by offering up what? Why? Because they were being what? They were being taught that by false brethren. Back in Acts 15, verse 1, 5, and 10. If you take garbage notes, you're going to be simple as hell when you go back home. I'm not going with this again. Hope you're looking at me the whole time. Writing down the chapter and verse and just sitting there. Write down what you're writing the chapter and verse 4. Got a bunch of scriptures. Don't know what the hell it's for. You're reading scriptures. Hope you ain't doing that. You will be lost. Go back to 1 Corinthians 14 and 20.
1 Corinthians 14 and 20. Brethren, be not children in understanding, howbeit in malice be ye children, but in understanding be men.
Read it again.
Brethren, be not children in understanding.
Go ahead.
Howbeit in malice be ye children.
What does that part mean? Howbeit in malice be ye children. What's that mean? Don't be children in understanding, but in malice be children. What does that mean? Malice means, you know how a child is. You know when children fight?
There you go.
Then you know they're playing again.
Listen to the analogy that is given. That's why I'm saying
that. You know, see children, I saw it today. They're fighting. I think it was Mo in Manasseh. They were fighting over a car or something, right? He's like, no, he started crying. Then later on, they're going to play together again. They get mad at each other, and then they play again. It happens all the time. So he's saying, in that instance, be children. And children will fight and argue, but eventually they'll get along again. They become friends again. It's forgotten. Children, like I said, they have short-term memory. They'll fight. They'll kick each other, bite each
y'all
other.
Y'all ain't
then
never
they'll
seen
play
that?
All over again.
Y'all ain't never seen that where the kids, one will punch the other one in the eye. Bam!
Yep.
And then the next minute, they playing together like nothing ever happened.
Right. So let me ask a question. When he says in malice, be ye children, what's the opposite of in malice not being children? You're going to see if you got it. Your hand went up first. Yes.
Holding on to it forever?
That's what y'all do here. Y'all right here do that. You got people who walk through these doors week after week and not speak to somebody. That's why he said, in malice be ye children. You used to do, you already trained that way when you were young and you're like that in your adulthood. So it's nothing for you to not speak to somebody. You'll just come in, you won't say shalom, no nothing. That's why he said, in malice be ye children, like he just said. You know how many kids come up to me, your son did this to me, your son did that to me, and then I go right back downstairs, they playing and laughing and joking. Because they forgot about it, they got over it. But the reason why the Most High said, in malice be ye children, because grown-ups are mean. Mean. They will hold on to things forever, and they won't let it go. And the nation can't grow like that. That's why Christ put so much emphasis on forgiveness. Because some of y'all do not know how to let things go.
Right. When you like that, you're a child in understanding.
Exactly.
When you like that, you're a child in understanding. That's why it says, be children in malice.
In your, even in your day-to-day lives, even husband and wives, you know how many people will come up, couples will come up over and over and over arguing about the same thing mm-hmm. for us to mediate it and squash it? We're dealing with two children, mm-hmm. two people who could quote scriptures but have not applied them. Okay? That's why the problem can never be resolved. Somebody got to say, you know what? Let's just forgive and let's move on. But for a couple to be with each other year after year after year after year and it's just arguing and arguing and arguing, that's a perfect analogy.
Go to Matthew 11 and verse 16.
The book of Matthew chapter 11 verse 16. But whereunto shall I liken this generation?
Christ, he's funny. He insults people indirectly. He goes, how shall I compare this generation of men here? Go ahead.
It is like unto children.
They're like kids, Christ says. Go ahead.
Sitting in the markets.
Sitting in the markets. Who was he referring to that sat in the markets? Hold that, get Acts 16, verse 19. What's the markets referring to? The markets was a gathering where the elders judge matters. That's what it was. Acts 16, 19, real quick. The precept for that.
Acts 16, 19. And when her masters saw that the hope of their gains was gone.
You know who?
And when her masters saw that the hope of their gains was gone.
This is a woman that was a witch that was giving these men business. Do a witchcraft. Go ahead.
They caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers.
Unto who?
The rulers.
So the marketplace is where the rulers dwelled to judge matters. They had assemblies there. The marketplaces or markets. Go back.
Matthew 11, 16.
Yeah.
But whereunto shall I liken this generation?
Now you know who he's talking about. He's talking about, he's insulting the elders that were standing there. Go ahead.
It is like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows.
Go ahead, their people. Go ahead.
And saying, we have piped unto you, and ye have not danced.
We pipe unto you like kids in school. The children will have certain cliques. And you don't play along with that clique or do what they do, they ostracize you. You lame. You're square. You whack. You whack. What are those? Make fun of your sneakers. Make fun of your shoes. Kids are cruel as hell, man. They mock you to you ready to kill yourself, man. They mock your death. Look like he killed himself. Ah, world star. And they put on world star. Wicked as hell, man. Read on.
And saying, we have piped unto you, and ye have not danced.
Yeah, man, we piped. We got the new dance. Nay, nay, you won't dance till you whack. You won't dance, girl. You won't dance like a girl like us. You whack. You corny. Go ahead.
We have mourned unto you, and ye have not lamented.
What's that rapper that died recently in the car accident? Shorty Low was the name? Yeah, Shorty Low died, man. Who the hell is that? Oh, you whack. You know who Shorty Low is? It's the same ignorance. Children, because you're not down with them, you're down with that nonsense. What happened? Just don't say it. Continue. He's going to say it.
For John came neither eating nor drinking.
So John wasn't down with that stuff, not eating or drinking.
And they say, he hath a devil.
They mock him because he ain't down with them. He got a devil on him. Go ahead.
The Son of Man came eating and drinking.
I show up after John. Go ahead. And I eat and drink, unlike John did.
And they say, behold, a man gluttonous and a wine bibber.
They slander me too. Go ahead.
A friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children.
But wisdom proves that I'm not gluttonous, I'm not a wine bibber, and John was not a devil. Wisdom justifies her children. Go to 1 Samuel 8 and verse 1. So Israel had childish mindsets. The leaders then, during Christ's time, and the leaders before his time were childlike.
1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 1. And it came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his sons judges over Israel. Now the name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second, Abiah. They were judges in Beersheba.
Samuel's sons, go ahead.
And his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre, and took bribes and perverted judgment.
Samuel's sons are wicked as hell. Go ahead. He was gone. He did this in his absence. Go ahead.
Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah.
He was from.
And said unto him, behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations.
Israel wanted a king like all the nations had their own kings. So Israel wanted a king based upon their emotions. Go ahead.
But the thing displeased Samuel. And when they said, give us a king to judge us, and Samuel prayed unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people and all that they say unto thee. For they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them.
So Israel didn't want the Lord over them. They wanted a fleshly man to be over them. That was their lust, to be like everybody else, just like today. They want to be like everybody else but themselves. Want to serve every other god but their own. Same thing. Let's jump down. Read on. Verse 8.
According to all the works which they have done since the day that I brought them up out of Egypt, even unto this day, wherewith they have forsaken me and served other gods, so do they also unto thee.
Go ahead.
Now therefore hearken unto their voice, howbeit, yet protest solemnly unto them.
So what they want, give it to them. But let them know there will be consequences behind wanting this. Go ahead.
And show them the manner of the king that shall reign over them.
Let them know what kind of king they're going to get based upon their own desire. Go ahead.
And Samuel told all the words of the Lord unto the people that asked of him of a king. And he said, this will be the manner of the king that shall reign over you.
A little faster. Go ahead.
He will take your sons and appoint them for himself, for his chariots, and to be his horsemen. And some shall run before his chariots. And he will appoint them captains over thousands and captains over fifties, and will set them to ear his ground and to reap his harvest and to make his instruments of war and instruments of his chariots.
He's going to make your sons to serve him. Go ahead.
And he will take your daughters to be confectionaries and to be cooks and to be bakers.
Now, sisters had jobs too, to be cooks, to bakers, and confectionaries. That was their positions. Go ahead.
And he will take your fields and your vineyards and your olive yards, even the best of them, and give them to his servants.
He'll take pieces of your land and give them to his men. You're going to lose your land. He's going to give them to the best of his own men. Go ahead.
And he will take the tenth of your seed and of your vineyards and give to his officers and to his servants.
He will tax you and take care of his men. Go ahead with the money.
And he will take your men servants and your maid servants and your goodliest young men and your asses and put them to his work.
He'll take your servants who take care of you and have them take care of him instead. That's the consequence. You won't be like everybody else. No problem. That's how your king's going to be. Go ahead.
He will take the tenth of your sheep, and you shall be his servants, and you shall cry out in that day because of your king, which he shall have chosen you, and the Lord will not hear you in that day.
You have complaints about your king. The Lord is going to ignore. I'm going to ignore you because this is what you wanted. You get what you asked for. Go ahead.
Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel.
After they heard all of that, they said, we don't care. We want our own king anyway. They didn't care. You see how evil and rebellious Israel is? Childish mindset.
That's the way they are today. Y'all still looking for some man to come on this earth. That's why y'all got your Martins, your Malcolms, your Jesse Jackson, your Al Sharpton, your Obama. That's the way your mind is. Now that y'all seeing your own people can't do nothing, now you're sitting there trying to say, which wicked white person do I want? Do I want Hillary or do I want Trump? Y'all really listening to the debates. Like y'all can sit and listen to their causes and say, you know what? The mudslinging they're throwing, you got Negroes sifting through it to see, well, this one hit her emails. I'm listening to them talk, and I'm like, I can't believe my ears is listening to this.
That's that deception that the Most High talked about when it says, when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them. You're so busy, yes, tied up in these dumb debates with Hillary Clinton. Y'all like that, right? That's who you vote for.
They said that never have they had an audience that they had now for the debates. Let me give y'all a precept. This is why what Deacon Adon is bringing out is so crucial. Go to Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 5. And this is what y'all have not got yet. And this is why we need a savior. There's no human being on the face of the planet that can fix things. This is real quick, this precept. Jeremiah 17, verse 5.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 17 and verse 5. Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man.
And that's how you people are. You really believe that some man is going to come without the law, statutes, and commandments of the Most High and make your life better. Okay? Especially women. You got wicked Negroes with their pants sagging off their behind, smoking weed, looking like a girl, tight pants, and you trust in that man that he's going to make your life better. And he's nothing that this Bible says. And you holding him up like he's God. Read it again.
Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm.
Because the fleshly arms of man are limited to what they can do to you. We want the spiritual arm of God that makes rain fall from the sky, the sun come every day, creates an atmosphere where we can breathe, lets the crops grow. He controls every aspect of life. And that's what was happening to the Israelites when they rejected what God had to offer and said, we want Saul. We want a man to reign over us because the other nations who have no God, they have a man over them. Mm-hmm. And that's the problem with Israel today. Y'all still looking for some man to come. That's why y'all entertain those stupid niggas in Harlem with those debates. They all come with different type of doctrines. One person explaining the atoms. One person is explaining metaphysics. Another person is explaining some new thing where you could telepathically speak to each other. And I'm like, yo, what is this garbage that these people are making up? And so many niggas are entertaining it. Negroes are making things up that you could put in a comic book. And there's a whole crowd on Harlem listening to them intentively, giving them money, waiting for their next debate. And next week, a new nigga come with some new science and some new madness. So what does it say? Read it again.
Cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm.
Read on.
And whose heart departed from the Lord.
That's the problem with us as a people. Our hearts have departed from God, and this is the result. You got a white woman and a white man that you're looking up to as your savior, who's going to bring forth the demise, the destruction of the planet.
Verse 20.
1 Samuel 8 and 20. That we also may be like all the nations, and that our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles.
That's what they want. That's what Israel wanted. Go to 9, verse 1 and 2.
Chapter 9, verse 1. Mm-hmm. Now there was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish, the son of Abiel, the son of Zeror, the son of Becharath, the son of Appiah, a Benjamite, a mighty man of power.
Mighty men, go ahead.
And he had a son whose name was Saul, a choice young man and a goodly. And there was not a man, the children of Israel, a goodlier person than he. From his shoulders and upward, he was higher than any of the people.
He was very tall. Saul was very tall. Go ahead. Verse 15.
Now the Lord had told Samuel in his ear a day before Saul came, saying, tomorrow about this time I will send thee a man out of the land of Benjamin, and thou shalt anoint him to be captain over my people Israel, that he may save my people out of the hand of the Philistines. For I have looked upon my people because their cry is come unto me.
Cry for king. Jump down to verse 21.
Verse 21. And Saul answered and said, am not I a Benjamite of the smallest of the tribes of Israel?
Benjamin thought, Saul thought small of himself. He said, not me. I'm not going to be no king. Right. I showed up to tell before a long time ago. Every leader we had in Israel never asked to be leader. The Lord picked them. They didn't see themselves as leaders. They said, nah, not me. Nah, I'm just a guy. I'm small means the poorest, the least. Read again.
And Saul answered and said, am not I a Benjamite of the smallest of the tribes of Israel?
Go ahead.
Am I family the least of all the families of the tribe of Benjamin?
Go ahead.
Wherefore then speakest thou so to me?
Why are you speaking to me, Samuel? Why me be king over Israel? Jump down to verse 10, verse 1.
10 and 1. Then Samuel took a vial of oil and poured it upon his head and kissed him and said, it is not because the Lord hath anointed thee to be captain over his inheritance.
So now we read that Saul became our king. All right? Saul became king after the children of Israel's own heart. Y'all follow? Go to chapter 12 and verse 13. I'm about to skim through this now.
1 Samuel 12:13. Now, therefore, behold, the king whom ye have chosen and whom ye have desired.
So he's saying, read again. We allow it.
Now, therefore, behold, the king whom ye have chosen and whom ye have desired.
To behold, the king whom you have chosen and desired. Behold, your king, King Saul. Go ahead.
And behold, the Lord hath set a crown, a king over you.
That's what you wanted, right? That's what Samuel's saying. Go ahead.
If ye will fear the Lord and serve him and obey his voice and not rebel against the commandment of the Lord, then shall both ye and also the king that reigneth over you continue following the Lord your God.
Uh-huh.
But if ye will not obey the voice of the Lord, but rebel against the commandment of the Lord, then shall the hand of the Lord be against you, and as it was against your fathers.
Uh-huh.
Now therefore stand and see this great thing which the Lord will do before your eyes.
Uh-huh.
It is not wheat harvest today. I will call unto the Lord, and he shall send thunder and rain that ye may perceive and see that your wickedness is great, which ye have done in the sight of the Lord in asking you a king.
Samuel is dissing them. Because you wanted a king, right? Now watch what I do. I'm going to call the Lord in heaven and have him send rain down. Your king can't do that. You wanted a king, right? Samuel was bad, man. They were scared of him. Samuel was bad. Hey. That's why his sons did evil when he was not present.
And Samuel set up Chris Gilliam. Y'all remember that show with Chris Rock where they took him to run for president because they just wanted any clown to go up and do it?
Yeah,
he got
the
big bus. He was doing everything
movie,
on black.
Yeah.
He got Bernie Mac to be.
Vice president.
That's what the Most High did for the nation of Israel. He just set up somebody and just threw somebody in there with no credentials to do it.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
So Samuel called unto the Lord, and the Lord sent thunder and rain that day. And all the people greatly feared the Lord and Samuel.
He scared them. Go ahead.
And all the people said unto Samuel, pray for thy servants unto the Lord thy God, that we die not.
That he doesn't kill us. What they asked was evil. Go ahead.
For we have added unto all our sins this evil to ask us a king.
Watch this. Continue.
And Samuel said unto the people, fear not. Ye have done all this wickedness, yet turn not aside from following the Lord, but serve the Lord with all your heart.
Go ahead.
And turn ye not aside, for then should ye go after vain things, which cannot profit nor deliver, for they are vain.
Like your presidents. Go ahead.
For the Lord will not forsake his people for his great name's sake, because it hath pleased the Lord to make you his people.
It hath pleased the Lord to make us his people. The Lord was happy to make us his people. All right? So now, you may ask yourself, well, if it was evil for Israel to ask for a king, then how do you explain Deuteronomy 17? Let's get that. You ever heard of childproof? Childproofing your car? Child can't open the locks, or you put a little gate up by your stairs so the child won't climb down the stairs. The Lord gave Moses the laws. He gave us childproof laws because Israel was simple as hell. So the Lord gave us laws beforehand because he knew later on we were going to do it. They even have for stoves. You put the thing on top of the stove knobs. They can't turn it.
They can't turn it.
The childproof knobs. Turners for the knobs on your stove. Right, a child will sit there and try to mess with it. It ain't working. Deuteronomy 17. Watch this. There are certain laws the Lord allowed Moses to establish based upon Israel's wickedness, being childish. 17, verse 14.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 17, verse 14.
But earlier that, Israel asking for a king was evil. So why is it in the law?
When thou art come unto the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee,
where we were during Saul's time,
and shalt possess it, and shalt dwell therein, and shalt say, I will set a king over me, like as all the nations that are about me.
Remember, this is before Saul was around. Talking a few decades. Decades later.
They hadn't even settled in the land, and he was telling them, this is what you niggas are going to do in the future.
Here's the law for what you're going to do against me. Here's the law for that.
He's letting them know in advance.
You know, there's an app for that for the phone? Well, here's the law for that, because y'all wicked as hell. Here's the law for that. Right. Same
wicked
thing.
As hell app.
Wicked as hell app, right. Reporting again.
When thou art come unto the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, and shall possess it, and shall dwell therein, and shall say, I will set a king over me.
He said, thou shalt say, I will set a king over me. I will. In the future, you're going to ask for a king over you. Go ahead.
Like as all the nations that are about me.
Y'all, as simple as hell, you're going to do this. So here's a law for it. Just in case you do, here's a law for it. Go ahead.
Thou shalt in any wise set him king over thee, whom the Lord thy God shall choose.
If you do decide to want a king, I have to choose him. Go ahead.
One from among thy brethren.
And he must be of your own people, because if you leave it to you, you'll pick a hamite over you, because y'all stupid as hell.
And y'all have bones in your nose.
And bowls in your lip. Go ahead.
Whom the Lord thy God shall choose, one from among thy brethren shalt thou set a king over thee. Thou mayest not set a stranger over thee, which is not thy brother.
Go ahead.
But he shall not multiply horses to himself.
These are things he should not do. Remember it said about Saul. Saul would do these things. Right. The law was to not do those things. But Saul did those things. Solomon did those things. Go ahead, read again.
But he shall not multiply horses to himself, nor cause the people to return to Egypt, to the end that he should multiply horses. For as much as the Lord has said unto you, ye shall henceforth return no more that way.
Go ahead.
Neither shall he multiply wives to himself.
Wasn't supposed to do that either. Have a whole bunch of women. Go ahead. Solomon did that too.
And that's good, because people use Solomon to promote whoremongering now. And look how that turned out. But it was in the law, you're not supposed to do that. But every Israelite that looks at Solomon, they say, well, he had 300 concubines and 700 wives. The law says you was not supposed to do that. He did that in lust and ignorance. Like Negroes do today.
Yep. Read on.
Neither shall he multiply wives to himself.
Why?
That his heart turn not away.
That's what happened to Solomon. His heart turned away from the Lord by having all the women he couldn't control.
And even think about it. If you have so much woman around you, how much time are you going to have to be in king? That's all your mind is going to be on 24/7, 7 days a week. Just like the dumb men that try that today. Okay? You ain't going to have no time to do work for the Lord. That's why it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 that time is short. Those of you who have wives, be as though you have none. That's why Paul said, I wish that all of you would be like me, which is how? How was Paul? Single, no wife. So you never hear none of the forefathers in the Bible pushing multiple wives and pushing to be around a lot of women. Most of the men that were dedicated to doing the Lord's work, they had one wife or no wife.
Go ahead.
Neither shall he multiply wives himself, that his heart turn not away. Neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver and gold.
That's what they did. Go ahead.
And it shall be when he sitteth upon the throne of his kingdom that he shall write him a copy of this law and a book out of that which is before the priests, the Levites.
That's all I want. So let's go to Deuteronomy 24, verse 1 and 2. So Moses gave Israel laws based upon their wickedness. Childproof laws. Childproof. Don't have a king over you, they're going to do it. Here's a law for that. They're going to do it because it's simple as hell. 24, verse 1 and 2.
Deuteronomy 24, verse 1.
Another childproof law.
When a man have taken to a wife and married her, and it came to pass that she find no favor in his eyes because he hath found some uncleanness in her,
go ahead,
then let him write her a bill of divorcement and give it in her hand and send her out of his house.
Go ahead.
And when she is departed out of his house, she may go and be another man's wife.
Matthew 19.
Before you even go there, Deacon, before you even go there, that was another law that was put in place for just what he said.
Yeah.
Okay? Because Moses, knowing how the men were, mm-hmm, he had to put that in place. Okay? I know you were going to read it, but it goes back to what he was saying. A lot of stuff that you're reading in Deuteronomy was to only to be prepared for the wicked brood of Negroes that was going to evolve. Okay, that's why Christ, when he comes and he steps on the scene, he's going to change things. That's why Paul, he said, be you followers of me as I am of Christ. Because the stuff that they learned before was wrong. A lot of the stuff that they learned was wrong. So with Christ came compassion. With Christ came mercy. With Christ came forgiveness. With Christ came true love, discipline. That's why he had disciples.
One wife.
One wife. He restructured the whole thing. So anytime you got an Israelite trying to take you into the Old Testament to look at the mistakes of our forefathers to try to get you to live that lifestyle now, you shut him down with what the deacon is bringing out.
Right.
Okay?
Matthew 19, verse 1.
Matthew 19 and 1.
No, verse 3.
Verse 3. The Pharisees also came unto him, tempting him, saying unto him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause?
Where's every cause in Deuteronomy 24 and 1? Every, just say it. Uncleanness in her. You find some uncleanness in
exactly
her is every cause. One eye bigger than the other.
Yes.
Her hair is too black.
Yes.
She's not tall enough. Okay. One toe bigger than the other toe.
You put on weight. I weighed you today. You put right on weight.
One breast bigger than the other. One butt cheek bigger than the other. I don't like that. What's going all on right with that butt cheek? What's going on? They mad. I don't like that. Any reason they can.
And he answered and said unto them, have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female? And said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother and shall cleave to his wife.
Go ahead.
And they twain shall be one flesh.
Be verse 4 again. Sorry, be 4 again.
Verse 4. And he answered and said unto them, have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning.
He took them before Moses. Go ahead.
Made them male and female.
Go ahead.
And said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother and shall cleave to his wife.
Go ahead.
And they twain shall be one flesh.
That's not in the law of Genesis. Go ahead. Talk about Adam and Eve. Go ahead.
Wherefore there are no more twain but one flesh.
But one. Go ahead.
What therefore God have joined together, let no man put asunder.
So what God's joined together, like he did with Adam and Eve, let no man put asunder. Remember, the argument is, did not Moses allow a man to put away his wife for every cause? So that's putting the marriage asunder.
That's right.
So Christ said, well, before Moses, that wasn't so at all. There was no divorce. Go ahead. Watch this.
They say unto him, why did Moses then command to give a writing of divorcement?
So if God said don't put the marriage asunder, then why did Moses allow Israel to end the marriage then if God put it together? They're being slick. They know the answer, but they're being slick. So it says they're tempting him. They're asking questions they don't know the answer to. Go ahead.
And to put her away.
Go ahead.
He saith unto them, Moses, because of the hardness of your heart, suffered you to put away your wives. But from the beginning, it was not so.
Likewise, he suffered us to have a king over us. But from the beginning, it was not so either. Childproof laws for childish Israelites.
Even the behavior of Solomon, that was to bring forth what's going on right now. Solomon couldn't control his lust for women. It cost him the kingdom. There was a split in us. Everything started to go wrong. And from that breakdown of the unity of the 12 tribes is where we are today.
Yep.
And Israelite groups will go to what Solomon did in wickedness and try to implement it now. Mm-hmm. With no that's too idiotic. It doesn't make sense.
Right. Read again. Read verse 8 again.
He said unto them, Moses, because of the hardness of your heart, suffered you to put away your wives. But from the beginning, it was not so.
Go ahead.
And I say unto you.
But I say unto you, now he's going to change things at this point. That's what Moses said, but here's what I say now. Go ahead.
Whosoever shall put away his wife, except.
So no longer do you put away your wife for every cause. No longer put away your wife for every cause. That's done away with. That ends now. Go ahead.
Except it be for fornication.
Only if she commits, she gets defiled. Go ahead.
And shall marry another.
Defiled.
Committeth adultery. And whoso marrieth her, which is put away, doth commit adultery.
So he's saying if a man puts away his wife for any cause aside from her being defiled, is an adulterer. Anyone who marries her while being put away, aside from adultery, is also an adulterer. That's not in Moses' law. No. That ain't in there at all. So where did it get it from? Christ established that law under the new covenant.
Now,
it's that simple.
Now I'm going to hit y'all with a headbanger. Based on what Christ said, is the reason why the woman is sitting over there and the man is sitting over here. Because you need to be in a learning environment where a lot of you come in here, a lot of sisters come in here, y'all want husbands. IUIC said, look, before you decide to go that route, there should be a time period for you to get to know each other.
Right.
Because you'll be just like those men that were putting away their wife for every cause. Because what y'all do? Y'all come in there, y'all look around, y'all not paying to none attention to nothing we're saying. Your eyes over there looking at the men are looking at the woman, and all y'all saying about is how cute each other look. Or your lust for each other. None of you don't know nothing about each other. None of you don't know how you are in the home, how she cooks, how she this, how she that. And y'all just hook up based on your lust with no time period to form a bond with each other. Well, you know each other, so guess what it ends in? Divorce. So that's why Christ said, no, you are not going to so easily just walk away from the woman.
Yep.
So we're telling you now, take time to know each other. Because you and your wickedness, you're going to find something wrong with that woman, or that woman is going to find something wrong with that man, and you're going to argue. So what Christ said was, I know how you people are. Y'all can't separate so easy. There's going to be consequences if you just jump into the relationship and decide, I don't want to do this no more. That's why he explained from the beginning, it was not so. In the beginning, you had to take time to know the sister. The sister had to bring you around her family. The family would examine you. And the family would say, yeah, I think they should be together. I like him. We've been watching him for a while. He's coming around. He's doing this. Okay, that's why the father gave you away. You people now, your minds are sick. Y'all would just look at somebody and right away y'all want to know their status. Do they have somebody or not? And y'all up in each other's face, not realizing that you're playing with your life.
Be verse 10.
His disciples say unto him, if the case of the man be so with his wife, it is not good to marry.
So they were raised up on put away for every cause. They said, if that be the case, don't get married at all.
Exactly.
Because their mindset was Moses, put away for every cause or some uncleanness in her. That's how they were brought up. They were
right.
Brought up on that.
Right.
Christ said, listen, I say unto you, that's done with. They said, well, if that's the case, Christ, we ain't get
right.
mad at all.
Because Christ told them you can no longer be a whoremonger.
Right.
However she come, you gotta find a way to love her and make the relationship work. And that's what Negroes cannot do.
But the law Moses established was the law to legally be a whore.
Right.
A whoremonger. That's what he did.
Right.
It's Israel that did it anyway. He said, fine, if you're gonna do it, here's the laws on how to regulate it.
Hey.
Likewise, to go back to the childproof.
Yes.
The king, the same thing. He set up childproof laws. Let me give you a Matthew 5 real quick.
It's no different from a prenuptial agreement.
Right.
Okay, you're coming into the relationship already signing paperwork that if this don't work, you can't take this from me. This is mine and that's. You already come in there like this. I don't have no long term. I don't trust you. I don't trust you. And you're not leaving with my money. When I decide that I find fault in you, I want to leave, and you're not taking half. Y'all got to think about that.
Matthew 5:31.
It has been said, whosoever shall put away his wife, let him give her a writing of divorce.
It has been said, you've read it in your law, but man put up, read again.
It has been said, whosoever shall put away his wife, let him give her a writing of divorcement.
Go ahead.
But I say unto you.
But I, stop. Here's the change here. But I say unto you. But that, I say unto you. Go ahead.
That whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, causeth her to commit adultery.
So you put away your wife except for being defiled. You're causing her to commit adultery. For example, I've heard Israel say things like, we're divorcing because of irreconcilable differences. That's not in the Bible.
Irreconcilable differences means she hate my guts and I hate her guts.
Right.
And we're not going to work things out. Right. We just hate each other.
So once she goes and marries somebody else, that man's an adulterer, she's an adulteress, and you're an adulterer. That's three deaths. That's how severe Christ made it now? Now you spread death to each other. You put her away. She accepts that putting away. Goes and marries somebody else. Now whoever she marries, that's adultery. If they know, if they know. During this time, they knew better. So he's saying, if you go off, she gets put away, except for the cause of fornication, and goes and marries somebody else. He knows that she got put away except for fornication. He's an adulterer. She's an adulteress, and you're an adulterer for putting her away. Christ advanced. He enhanced it. He magnified it. Read on. Let's go to, you finished it. Let's go to 1 Samuel 15:22.
The book of 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22. And Samuel said, hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord?
Does the Lord have more interest in sacrifice above obeying him? Go ahead.
Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice.
I prefer obedience above sacrifice. So the Lord was giving us hints in the beginning, sacrificing, I don't care about that.
Right.
I want you to obey me. That's what I want you to do. Go ahead. Read again.
And Samuel said, Have the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord?
Go ahead.
Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice.
Go ahead.
And to hearken than the fat of rams.
And to listen is better than the fat of the rams. I'd rather you listen than sit there and offer me an animal. But under the old covenant, that was established, so therefore he had to accept it. But after a while, he said, you know one thing? I'm going to establish a new covenant because these guys are going to break this one anyway.
Yep.
They're going to break it anyway. Go to Isaiah 42:21.
Isaiah 42:21. The Lord is well pleased for his righteousness' sake. He will magnify the law and make it honorable.
He will magnify the law and make it honorable. Magnify means he'll broaden it, make the understanding more clear, enhance it, alter it. That's what it means. Magnify means make it bigger, put more emphasis on things. That's what Christ did. And Israel did not like that. The law under Moses was, you commit adultery, you get death. Christ, when you bang somebody's wife, you get death. Christ said, no, I say unto you, even looking at her is adultery. They were like, damn, can't even look at him? Damn.
Yep.
They hated his guts because he magnified that law. They ain't just banging someone's wife no more. Not even if you even have the thought in your mind to look and to attempt to do it, you're an adulterer.
Hey, let me
enhanced it.
Let me hit him with another one. Give me 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. As he's speaking about the law being magnified and things being changed over what we had in the Old Testament.
First 1 Corinthians 11 and 1. Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ.
So Paul was letting it know, I am distancing myself from the way of the Pharisees, and I am now committing my walk to the ways of Christ. Read on.
Now I praise you, brethren, that ye remember me in all things and keep the ordinances as I deliver them
to
you.
So he's now giving them instructions, new instructions. He said, keep the ordinance as I deliver them unto you. Read on.
But I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is the man, and the head of Christ is God.
Because that structure was not in place. There was no order. Israel don't like order. That's why when you try to do that in your house, your women buck up. That's why when you're dealing with the other men, they buck up. That's why they're against Christ. They don't want to have Christ over them as their head. Now watch this, to prove what the deacon said about we need childproofing and we need structure. Watch this, read on.
Verse 4, every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonoreth his head.
When did they used to pray and prophesy with their head covered? In the old. Paul just shut that down. He said, from now on, take it off your head. Y'all lying if y'all don't say that there's a whole bunch of Israelite camps with stuff on their head. Before they would make a little hole. Now it's completely covered. You're seeing them with the mitres, and they're going into the old covenant to try to omit what Paul told them there. A lot of Israelite camps now, they got do-rags. They have, before they would make a little hole covering because they was trying to be cool. Now they don't care. So a lot of them hate Christ. They hate Christ. Okay? And they're established as an example to that to you so that you people can figure out who's telling the truth and who's not telling the truth. Who should we follow and who should we listen to? That's why it's not our job to sort these things out. That's a small, easy thing. A small, easy thing. And y'all will flip to that channel and watch them teaching with their head covered, knowing that they hate Christ and they dishonoring Christ.
And they heard the scriptures. They heard these scriptures that were bringing out.
And that's mind-boggling to me. Because the only reason why they exist is because wicked Israel exists. If nobody was watching their videos, they will conform and do what the scriptures say by the men that are setting the right example. But anytime they need views, they attack other people and make things up, and you go and listen to what they have to say. You know why? Because you're wicked your own damn self.
Let's see Leviticus real quick. 19 verse 17. Leviticus 19 verse 17.
You just proved the scripture. Let Ithan speak. When the scriptures say that the blood shall rise up to the horse's bridle, I now understand where it's going to come from. A lot of Negroes going to get put to death. I see that. There's going to be blood everywhere because there's a lot of wickedness out here. Negroes validate the Bible. I can read the Bible and then look out here and listen to some of the stuff that I hear. If I was not a believer, I would be a believer after seeing Israel.
Yep.
They make me a believer because they fit exactly what we're reading.
Leviticus 19, verse 17.
Leviticus 19, 17. Mm-hmm. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thine heart. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy neighbor and not suffer sin upon him.
You should not hate your neighbor, your brother in your heart. You shall in any wise rebuke him and not suffer sin upon him. Verse 18, real quick.
Thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself.
It goes back to in malice be ye children.
Y'all see how simple that is? A simple rule. Paul said, listen, from now on, we used to teach with our heads covered. From now on, nobody can cover your head because that's how you show your obedience to Christ. That's a simple thing. You get dressed to go to camp, nobody have nothing on their head. Is that a hard thing to follow? So why would you sit in front of men that are dishonoring Christ and let them teach you the scriptures? A simple understanding. The bishop showed you that 6-pointed star was of the devil. And you got them saying, no, we don't have no scriptures to put it down. We're spiritually wearing it. We're keeping it on. Okay? So little things that are coming out with concrete evidence, proof of the Bible, and our people still reject it. It's just like the analogy he gave of Saul. Samuel came and told him, listen, you people are making a horrible mistake putting this man up as your king. And they listened to what he said. They're going to abuse our daughters. He's going to abuse our young men. He's going to take our gold. He's going to take our silver. He's going to use our merchandise. They said, okay, we want it anyway. That's how black people are. So that's why Christ, when you read in the New Testament, he was dismissive. He was dismissive because he knew after a while, he knew all men. He knew what was in men. He needed not that any should come and testify of him, except because he knew what was in man. And after you're doing this for a while, you start to see what is inside our people. So you're very selective about who you deal with. You'll feel some of them out, and if you see that they're sincere, they really want help, and they come with that humble spirit that you're looking for, that's who you give your time to. That person that's always whiny, why this, you dismiss them. Because they're not there to listen. Satan has sent them to occupy your time to hinder the rebuilding of the nation. The people that are sincere about learning, they're going to humble down and do exactly what these scriptures say, unquestioned.
Deacon Asaph said that you said that you observed about 5 videos with people being against the full moon.
It's way more than 5 now. It was 5 in the middle of the week. And those men were gearing up to attack for the Sabbath day.
And there's no scriptures that they come up with?
And there's no scriptures.
The Most High calls that rebellion.
Okay.
And rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft.
Witchcraft. They're witches.
Go to Deuteronomy 21, verse 15. Deuteronomy 21, verse 15. We just read, love your neighbor as yourself. Now we're going to read this real quick. Deuteronomy 21, verse 15.
Deuteronomy 21, verse 15.
Yeah.
If a man have 2 wives.
Here we go again. Man have 2 wives. Go ahead.
One beloved,
one he loves,
and another hated.
What's the problem with that? Another hated. What law does that violate?
We just read it. We just read it. Every hand should go up.
Love your neighbor as yourself. Go ahead.
Wow. If a man have 2 wives, one beloved and another hated, and they have borne him children.
One loved has a child for him, one hated has a child for him.
Both the beloved and the hated.
Go ahead.
And if the firstborn son be hers that was hated.
If the firstborn son be born the one that he doesn't like. Go ahead.
Then it shall be when he maketh his sons to inherit that which he hath, that he may not make the sin of the beloved firstborn before the son of the hated.
That the one whose son of the hated may receive more than the one he loves. The son that he loves. One that he loves. Go ahead.
Which is indeed the firstborn.
Go ahead.
But he shall acknowledge.
Go ahead.
But he shall acknowledge the son of the hated for the firstborn by giving him a double portion of all that he hath. For he is the beginning of his strength. The right of the firstborn is his.
There's 2 problems with this. The first problem is he hates his wife, number one.
There you go.
The second problem is, why is there a law to tell him that? Your firstborn automatically should inherit what you have. That's your firstborn.
Nigga,
Moses had to give a child-proof law for Negroes to take care of the child of their firstborn. Because they have a grudge towards the mother of that child, they take it out on the firstborn. So Moses had to give us laws to take care of children of women we don't like. Today, that's called child support today. That's what child support is today.
That's right. Because Moses was the founder of BCW.
Right. Because, remember, because this law was pushed by our own people. Our own people said, the hell with you, nigga, I ain't listening to you.
That's right.
They said, fine, I'm going to have the worst, vilest, most evil nation on the earth do it to you and extort you at the same time.
That's right.
Visa do it to you. That's how child support came into existence.
That's right.
But before that, we had this law right here that was set up for wicked Negroes. Child-proof laws for Negroes who have children by a woman that they hate, which they shouldn't hate at all, to take care of a child that they should know to take care of in the first place.
Exactly.
These are child-proof laws. For a child-minded nation, once again. This shouldn't even be a law, but it's a law because Moses had to regulate the evil among us.
That's right.
He had to do it.
Hey,
now,
wait, one more before you move on. Well, I'm going to ask
right,
that
go
question.
Ahead, go ahead.
It's the same thing in the New Testament where it says, he that provided not for his own, especially they of his own household, is worse than an infidel. How many mothers you see trying to track down the father to find him to get money from them right now? And it's written in God's law. And you know why you're tracking that nigga down for child support? Because you omitted the law. You didn't go with a man according to the law, statutes, and commandments of the Most High. That's why you're not getting no money. That's why you're complaining that this guy don't care. Now, Deacon Yawasab asked a question before we even got to this. Because he said that you got one wife you love and one wife you hate. Why would you marry a woman that you hate? That's the question there. Why would you marry a woman that you hate? I'm going to tell you the first way how it starts, because of what I just pointed out now. You didn't get to know her. You were looking at her behind. You were looking at how simple she was. She had stars in her eyes. She saw all the signs that she was a no-good Negro, and she bypassed all of them for some lust that she had inside of her. And that's how you wind up in a relationship with a man that hates you. And then you're trying to figure it out. You're saying, is it me? What did I do wrong? And no, it's not you. You just got hooked up with somebody who don't know God. And that's why a lot of your relationships will not be fixed in this kingdom. There's no remedy to fix your relationship. A lot of, and I'm saying this because that's the number one call that we get. They realize when they come into the truth, they were the loser, and they're asking us how to fix it. And they've already made it clear he wants nothing to do with the scriptures. That's done. That's over. You're not salvaging that relationship.
Get Ephesians 5. They want to go. Get Ephesians 5:33. Regarding the law of love thy neighbor as yourself. Is that only referring to your brothers? Let's see. Ephesians 5:33. Paul expounds upon Leviticus 19, verse 17 to 18.
Ephesians 5:33. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself.
Let every one of you so love his wife even as himself. Love your neighbor as yourself. Your neighbor is also your wife. Go ahead.
And the wife see that she reverence her husband.
That she loves her husband. Love your neighbor as yourself. It goes vice versa. Same thing. Love your neighbor as yourself goes into marriage also. All right, now let's get Deuteronomy 18, verse 15 and 19. We're almost done. Two more to go. Deuteronomy 18, verse 15 to 19. So when Paul came into an understanding of Christ, his knowledge he had as a Pharisee was enhanced. He progressed. He exceeded his understanding that he had in Christ rather than as a Pharisee. Because Christ magnifies the law, and he forces your understanding to be magnified also when you read this law. Read that.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, verse 15. Mm-hmm. The Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like unto me.
Like unto me.
Unto him ye shall hearken.
Now, some will say this is Joshua. Now, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to cut it real fast. You had the Lord spoke to Moses. Moses spoke to us. When Joshua came, set foot in the scene, you had the Lord, Eleazar, then Joshua, then Israel. Big difference. The Lord spoke to Moses face to face. Joshua had to go to Eleazar, the priest, to speak to the Lord. Big difference. Not like unto Moses. So don't fall for that garbage. You understand? Yes, I'm going to say it again. The Lord, Eleazar. So Eleazar mediated between the Lord and Joshua, then Joshua to Eleazar, then Eleazar to Joshua to Israel. There was an order of things. Then Moses spoke to him face to face. There was no mediation. I got to talk to somebody else to talk. No, it was face to face, and he went to Israel, or he went to Aaron. You understand? So he said, like unto me, it means like Moses, just like you. I'm going to deal with him. Read again.
Thou shalt set, excuse me, Deuteronomy 18,
15.
Verse 15. The Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like unto me. Unto him ye shall hearken.
Go ahead.
According to all that thou desirest of the Lord thy God in Horeb, in the day of the assembly, saying, let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, neither let me see this great fire anymore, that I die not.
Because Israel is so rebellious. Listen, Moses, you know one thing, Moses? We don't want to hear you. We want to hear the Lord himself. The Lord said, really? Okay, I'll speak. And when he spoke, they said, okay, yeah, about that, talking to him, yeah, scratch that. We'll talk to you again. We're going to talk to you again. We don't like what we just heard and saw at the same time. Let's just deal with you from now on. That's what happened. Go ahead.
And the Lord said unto me, they have well spoken that which they have spoken.
The Lord said, good job. Go ahead.
I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee.
Like unto you. Go ahead.
And will put my words in his mouth.
Go ahead.
And he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him.
Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak in my name.
Meaning my words, go ahead.
I will require it of him.
I will kill him. Require his bloodshed. That's what he's saying. Require it of him means his bloodshed. Okay, that's what it means. Now, let's get Luke 9:28. Because that's the law. Because remember, when Paul stepped foot in the scene, the Lord told Ananias that he would be a chosen vessel unto me. So Christ dwelt spiritually in Paul. Christ was speaking to us through Paul. Y'all understand? Like all the prophets, the Lord spoke through the prophets in the Spirit unto us, likewise through Paul. So when Paul gave commandments to the churches, which lead up to us now, that was Christ speaking through Paul. One wife, that was Christ speaking through Paul. It's that simple. So the words that Christ spoke unto us when he walked the earth, and the words he spoke unto us in the Spirit through the disciples and the apostles, it's the same thing. Luke 9:28. But let's see what happens. Let's see what Israel does now.
The book of Luke, chapter 9, verse 28.
Watch this.
And it came to pass about an eight days after these saying, he took Peter and John and James and went up. And
these three men became the elders. Peter, James, and John. Peter was first leader, then James and John. John, Revelator. Go ahead.
And went up into a mountain to pray. And as he prayed, the fashion of his countenance was altered.
Changed.
And his raiment was white and glistering.
Go ahead.
And behold, there talked with him two men, which were Moses and Elias.
So you got to imagine this. He had 12 disciples. He said, nah, just you three, because he had his boys. Those are his men. John he loved. But Peter, James are going to be the elders. Paul called them pillars in Galatians. Galatians 2, he called them pillars. Those are the elders. He said, you three come with me. I want to show you something. And when he came, went up to a mountain, he began to glow. He transformed. He glowed. And then he glowed. Elijah and Moses appeared. Elijah and Moses. Now, these are two dead men that appeared to him like nothing. He's talking to them, conversing with them like it's regular. So you got to imagine their minds right now. Their minds are blown at this point. Read on.
Who appeared in glory and spake of his decease, which he should accomplish at Jerusalem.
And Moses and Elijah spoke to Christ regarding his death. Go ahead.
But Peter and they that were with him were heavy with sleep.
Go ahead.
And when they were awake, they saw his glory and the two men that stood with them.
Go ahead.
And it came to pass as
they... So he brought them up there. And they sat, it took a while. He said, once they started dozing off, then when they woke up, they see Moses and Elijah standing there talking to them. They bugged out. Read again.
But Peter and they that were with him,
James and John,
were heavy with sleep. And when they were awake, they saw his glory.
They saw Christ altered, his countenance white and glistering. Go ahead.
And the two men that stood with him.
And they saw Elijah and they saw Moses. Go ahead.
And it came to pass as they departed from him, Peter said unto Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here.
Master, it's good that we're here to see this. Go ahead.
And let us make three tabernacles.
Let us make us three tabernacles. Now, Moses represents what? One word. Law. What does Elijah represent? The prophets. So you have the law and the prophets speaking to the Son of God. You follow? Peter said, let's build three individual tabernacles, one for you, one for the law, and one for the prophets, separating them, right? Go ahead.
Not knowing what he said.
What he said was ignorant. He said what he said out of ignorance. He didn't know any better. Watch this. Go ahead.
While he thus continued speaking
on that, building three tabernacles, watch this.
There came a cloud and overshadowed them.
Here comes a chariot that overshadowed. It was huge. It overshadowed them. Go ahead.
And they feared as they entered into the cloud.
And they had to walk in. So, listen. They had to walk. Okay. The chariot comes on a mountain. It goes on the top of the mountain. They had to go inside of it. They had to walk. All four of them are walking inside of this chariot. Watch this. Go ahead.
And there came a voice out of the clouds.
So now, you have to imagine, you're walking into this chariot and there's a big, great black man's voice, James Earl Jonas type of voice, you know, it's deep, comes out the chariot, go ahead.
Saying, this is my beloved son, hear him.
What does that mean?
You
got to
read that with thunder. You got to read. They got to put thunder and bass and all kinds of things when you read that part.
This is my beloved son. Hear him. What's he saying here? We read it earlier, actually.
That we're going to follow after Christ. That he's the prophet that we're going to follow after him. And we're going to be under his law, which is, you know, like no more sacrificial law.
Very good. He supersedes them both. That's what he's saying to you. Yeah, I'm talking to both of them. Because remember, the words that Christ spoke were the same words that they spoke. The law and the prophets. But the Father said, yeah, that's true. But hear him. Like Moses told you in Deuteronomy 18, listen to him or I'll require it of you, meaning I will kill you. And the words that Christ spoke unto us were the words you read about in Paul's letters. Acts, which is Luke's letter. Then you have Paul's letters afterwards. Romans, Philippians, those are Christ's words. So whatever Paul said to us was what Christ was saying to us that was commanded of us to listen to according to the law of Moses. So one wife, guess what? Is according to the law of Moses. Because one wife is found in Deuteronomy 18, verse 15 through 19. One wife is found in Luke 9, 28 to 35. Hear him. That's one wife right there. Until Isaiah 4 and 1 comes in, the kingdom, then that reestablishes the more than one. Isaiah 4 and 1 again. That's the law telling you when you can have more than one again. And even that will be restricted. There won't be no 5,000. No.
That's right.
Even that time it's going to be, okay, you have this many.
Right.
All right, I got to get this stuff. I'm jumping.
That thing in Deuteronomy, you just dropped the bomb.
That's right.
Damn. Who knows? What's the bomb that was dropped in Deuteronomy? He got his hand up. I'm going to be quick. You almost done? I thought that was it. Brother up front. Yeah, you. What was the bomb that was dropped? Quote the scripture first. What scripture am I talking about?
Deuteronomy 18, 18.
Okay, what does it say there?
That Christ is the prophet that they're talking about. That would be speaking of the Most High's words.
So, just like, exactly. So what it says, it says, I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, one like unto thee, and I will put my words in his mouth, and they shall, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command you. Then it says, and who and what it say, what 19 say? You read 19, right? Read 19. And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. So who is this talking about? Who's
Christ.
Moses speaking about?
Christ.
So that's going into the thing that you brought out about hear ye him. So why in the world would a Negro try to run to Moses and to go over Christ? These,
and that's what we're going through right
and
now.
And Moses is telling yourself, hear him, just like what you just read in the New Testament, hear ye him.
That is what we're going through right now. You had Moses who gave you the law. You had Elijah who was a prophet. And you had Christ. And God had to get witnesses to say, listen, I don't care what y'all was doing before. Y'all going to listen to him. So that's why Paul was able to speak so boldly and say, you follow after me according to the ordinance that I gave you. Whatever you had on your head, take it off. You guys were messing around with a whole bunch of women. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. Now you only stay with one wife, and a woman is supposed to have her own husband. You men now, because there's Israelite camps that stop putting fringes on their garments. Y'all see that? No fringes at all. Okay? They say, yes. You don't have to put the fringes on. The fringes are in your heart. Where did Moses say to put fringes on your heart?
That's
and
that
he said to look, that you're supposed to look upon them to remember the commandments.
They got a death
wish. You
got to cut
your heart open.
Yes, you got to cut your heart open and be like, yeah, there go my fringes right there beating on my heart.
Well, he might
you
find them.
You dumb, stupid Negro. So the Most High is playing with y'all to the point where he's making this so simple that when you die, you cannot argue with him while you're dying. He's making it so easy for you to go against him with a simple thing like put fringes on, only stay with one woman, don't teach with your head covered, don't have hatred for your brother. These things are visible. You're seeing them right in front of your face, and black people are still omitting them and still going after their lusts. So now that we're approaching the end and Christ is coming, that's why there's going to be such a high body count. We're not going to be wondering, why did you kill so many people? Because we're seeing so many people rebel right now, right in front of our faces, over the simplest things.
That's okay? Why Christ said, if you would have believed Moses, you would have believed me, because he wrote of me. This is what it's talking about, because Moses is taking you right to Christ. That's what he's saying here. Follow him.
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel, Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to Join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC to stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.